That's literally what we can expect.
I need to show you. I took creeper photos of how do I describe this? In an alternate universe, Brian Brushwood and Justin Robert Young get a movie made about their lives in Hollywood, but like the regular casting falls through, and these are the two guys that end up playing it.
Oh my God. That's too close.
Oh my God, that's great.
Wow.
I was at In and Out, and I look up, and it's like the South Park version of Brian and Justin.
That's amazing.
And I'm taking photos, and people are looking at me. We're like, you don't understand. Like those are like the Frosted Tip LA versions of two of my buddies.
Let me do. You want to set levels real quick? Because I feel like I'm lower than everyone else.
I mean, I spot, faux Justins on a regular
This
basis.
is a constant thing, yeah, for sure.
I mean, Justin will get a photo of, some guy looks like him, and then it'll be, some homeless guy with his pants around his ankles standing on a street.
And by the way, you were the OG person, but now it's become an internet-wide like situation. Like everybody is always finding fake me's.
Well,
Yep,
there was those
everywhere.
guys that were doing nothing but finding Jerry's beards, out in the wild.
Yeah.
Let me see if
I
I
was
can
just a
adjust
fake Brian and a fake Justin together. That was just like the trifecta, the dufecta,
that. Well,
the
now I hang
bifecta.
that.
Didn't work out so hot.
Yeah, Bryce, we're over here now. When you're not behind the seat, we're I don't know.
We're liable to run around with our pants
We're yeah,
off.
whatever, man. You ain't got.
Yeah.
You're not the boss of me.
Except for when you are.
Except for when I need you to be. Please just explain to me how to do everything. I'm sorry I upset you. All right, I think we're good. I think we're doing stuff. Let's take a real quick check. 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 1, 2, 3. Brian, can you give me levels?
Yo, buddy, this is about the level I'm going to talk the entire show long.
Andrew?
Excuse me while I set
This is going to
the
be
quiet.
the level about which I speak at. Unless I yell.
Oh, Jesus. Oh, Jesus. Okay, here we go. That's good. Check, check, check. 1, 2, 3. Brian, can you give me levels?
Yo, buddy, this is about the level I'm going to talk the entire show long.
Andrew?
Excuse me while I set
This is
the
going to be the
quiet.
level about which I speak at.
Perf. There we go. All right. I think we're good. Are we
Yeah,
ready?
let me tweet y'all.
Yeah, let's tweet it.
Been there, done that.
All right, all right, all right, all right.
Cool. All right, are we ready to go? Let's get ready in 3, 2.
Hello and welcome to the Weird Things broadcast. I'm Andrew Main, joined by my co-host, Justin Robert Young.
Hi, I'm here in Austin, Texas.
And Brian Brushwood.
Dude, I'm terrified because not only is Justin in Austin, but he's driving the ship. We are without one Bryce Neshcom Castillo, and instead we got Justin behind the mic and at the controls.
It's a problem.
Brian, it's like you invited everybody over for like Thanksgiving dinner and it's time to cut the turkey and you're looking at the power knife and you're like, oh, I don't know what to do. And you hand it to Justin.
Well, it wasn't so much like that. It was like I started to carve the turkey and I walked away and Justin happened to be like looking up wrestling results on his phone and he happened to be in front of the turkey and I was like, you just want to take it? And he's like, yeah, sure. All right.
Yeah, I can carve a turkey. And then I realized how woefully inadequate I am at carving a turkey halfway through.
But it was pretty impressive because like Justin's setup is close enough to the one here. You know, partly because of the symbiotic relationship of, you know, working together to figure out like, hey, how do you do this? Well, I do it this way and so on. So enough of it was familiar that he was able to just sit down. And, you know, it turns out once you learn how to fly a starship, other starships are real similar.
That's a fact.
It's a very applicable skill, Andrew. You know, I'll be able to do this all over the world now in the two rigs that are set up similar.
As these ramshackle millennium
exactly.
Falcons.
I'll be able to pilot both Chitty Chitty Bang Bangs.
Well, gentlemen, you know where it would be great for you to pilot Chitty Chitty Bang Bang, which, by the way, I do have a pop-up book for that book.
Really?
Wow.
Do you know who wrote that book, by the way?
Professor Chitty?
Nope.
Go on.
Guess again.
Oh.
Don Knotts.
Nope.
Don Rickles.
Very famous writer. Very famous writer.
Mark Twain.
Give you a hint. He created one of the most famous characters in all of literary and film.
Sir Arthur Conan Doyle.
No.
Chuck Tingle.
Chuck Tingle.
This is starting to get
Tom Clancy.
Dr. All Seuss. Right.
All right. Can I just tell you?
Yes.
The novel Chitty Chitty Bang Bang was written by Ian Fleming.
Oh wow.
I don't know whether or not he was funning, but Reverend Puck there in the chat got it.
Hey, yeah. By the way, I want to thank you for showing off those pop-up books a while ago. I got three of them, one for each of my daughters. I got the Frozen pop-up. I got the Japanese art, the waves. Is it called Hokusai or whatever it is? I got one of those for my oldest, and my middle one got the Lego pop-up book, and they have all been amazing, dude. Pop-up books are works of gorgeous, gorgeous art.
I'm telling you, man, I'm a big fan of those. But we're not here to talk about pop-up books, Chitty Chitty Bang Bang. What we are here to talk about is where we might fly to in Chitty Chitty Bang Bang and decide to make a pop-up book about. You know, there are so many mysteries in this world and there's so little time. And sometimes I feel remiss when we don't cover all of them. And I have one in particular, which really has been kind of neglected by us.
Really?
And this is It's a monster.
Uh-huh.
The monster, there may have been an indirect sighting.
Okay. Now I feel like...
On a tree trunk, claw marks. Claw marks on a tree trunk left by this monster. And apparently the tree claw marks started about 8 feet off the ground and go almost 12 feet. And it's in a forest. I got to warn you here. I don't want to frighten anybody with the name of this monster.
I mean, does the name of the monster relate to the size of an appendage?
Wait, what? Oh.
What?
Oh,
no.
Like Bigfoot?
Yeah.
Okay.
No. Okay, gotcha. Brian and I went totally wrong directions on that one.
Man, you know, weirdly...
Bigfoot, right?
No. Weirdly, I think he's playing coy, and uh-huh. That the monster...
Coy?
I think he is playing coy, and the monster is lightning. I can see lightning bolt striking a tree and leaving a strange-looking claw mark about... What'd you say, 7 to 12 feet long?
Well, I mean, it starts about 8 feet up, goes to like 12 feet on the tree. Brian, I'm not gonna lie to you about monsters. I'm just saying this is a monster. This is actually a named monster that a monster hunter said, yes, we think it's the blank, blank, blank. Okay.
Oh, three words.
Yeah. So it's not. Words. I mean, the Loch Ness monster doesn't get out. I mean, although, how would maybe they got scuba suits now?
Yeah.
And they get up on land, and Nessie comes down to the deeps, and you're like, I've done it. I found up in the ghost worlds that
well,
I've created
last,
this apparatus.
Blank, 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 blank. The last blank is monster.
Yeah. All right. So that, okay, that's confirming my theory.
The Frankenstein.
The Frankenstein.
The first word is Alabama.
The Alabama slipper.
The monster.
Alabama slammer monster.
Alabama alligator monster. No, the Alabama slammer monster.
Alakazammer.
At the Alabama alabaster.
It was a memorable Friday the 13th for Donald McDonald of the unfortunate named men's club. Of the Gulf Coast Bigfoot Research Organization when he was invited to speak at the annual Collard Green Festival in Evergreen earlier this
Stop
month.
Stop it. Stop
no,
it.
Keep going. This is great.
I swear to God. like five times to like make sure it's not like, because there are so many now of these spoof websites that.
Fake news. Yeah, that's what it's all about.
But they had a pretty good article about Auburn's defensive recruits, so I was thought it was pretty good. So anyhow, he was invited to speak at the annual Collard Green Festival in Evergreen earlier this month. He had no idea he discovered evidence of the legendary creature in Conoco County. But when a resident of the Pine Orchard community pointed out claw marks on a tree in his yard, McDonald determined they couldn't have been made by humans, and it's unlikely they're made by any other animals. No. Quote.
Wait, including a Bigfoot?
Brian?
Oh, sorry.
Are you reading this?
Sorry,
no. Are you doing the research?
No. Hey, I'm sorry.
Pipe down.
I'm just really excited. This is like the moment when somebody drops a zinger on Married with Children. I have to be the one that goes, ooh.
Listen, Donald McDonald doesn't come into your podcast studio until you had to do your job, all right?
Some of these claw marks started about 8 feet off the ground and go to almost 12 feet, McDonald said. Yes. There are bears in the area, but a bear, if it would have made those marks, there would have bear claw marks on the sides of the tree where it climbed. There were none.
Hey, how tall is a human, a human 6 feet and reaches up and they can reach like 7 or 8 feet, right?
Yeah, it goes 8 to 12.
How tall is a bear when a bear stands up?
Depends on the bear, Brian.
Yeah.
Oh, give or take.
Big bear? A baby bear.
Koala bear. I mean, probably like 4 feet.
Well, I don't know. It just seems like a bear is bigger than a human. And if it stood up, it'd be, you know, a little bit bigger than a human.
You know, I don't know. I don't like all this sass you're giving Donald McDonald.
I mean, it just seems like if they reached up, there would be like a claw mark from point A to point B.
Listen, can you please focus on what we really need to know,
yeah,
which is the third word in the Alabama blank.
Yeah,
monster.
Okay. Yeah, that's right.
Come on.
I'm burying the lead here.
Yeah.
Let's see. The terror monster.
The Alabama terror monster?
Yeah. No.
What is this, a minor league baseball team?
The Alabama jazz monster.
Now, let me go to another article. This is from a few days ago that sourced this, and it's not as credible as the AL.com website. Perhaps, uh-huh. It's a more. Anyhow, one of the researchers there was from the show Killing Bigfoot, which, you know, shows you how different my home
that's
state
the,
of Alabama
that's the new
is the
Bill O'Reilly
world.
Book, right? After What's Killing that? Lincoln, Killing Jesus, yeah. Killing JFK, Killing Bigfoot.
So, Killing Bigfoot researchers say there are monsters in Pine Orchard, Alabama. There's definitely monsters in the woods in and around Conoco County, according to Bigfoot researchers who visited the county last week. Donald McDonald and Michael Humphreys, it's about as southern as you can get, from the TV show Killing Bigfoot, arrived in Conoco County on Friday morning to investigate recent reports of Bigfoot in our area and to put on a program about Bigfoot at Saturday's Collard Green Festival.
God, so wait, was he just like, he's like, well, I'm in town for the Collard Green Festival, so like, let's just knock out some of this Bigfoot research.
This is a Coen Brothers movie waiting to happen.
Okay, the Alabama.
All right,
slice monster.
All right, let me go ahead.
He loves the soda.
So McDonald, who lives in Mississippi, and Humphreys, who lives in Oklahoma, teamed up on Friday afternoon with one of the biggest Bigfoot enthusiasts in our part of our state, Ashley McFall of Excel. They let me tag along as they investigated some of the local Bigfoot hotspots Also in our group were the wives of Donald and Humphreys, Vanessa and Kathy, who said they enjoyed hunting for signs of Bigfoot almost as much as their husbands. After fueling up with a big lunch.
What?
Oh, yeah. I wonder what they were eating. Which festival was it?
Yeah, exactly. Well, you know, I mean, I did bring some, you know, treats back from the festival. Yeah. So
it's Wheat Thins.
Yeah.
Well, it goes on to describe their hike around the woods looking for signs of it, and then they found the large claw marks on the tree.
Man, that is crazy that three world famous experts in the field of monster hunting found evidence of a monster.
Well, it makes sense.
When a few minutes later we came upon a large tree on the side of a steep slope that led down into a rocky bottom behind the old man's house. Starting an estimated 6 to 7 feet off the ground was a large claw mark that had ripped away the dark green moss covering the tree's trunks. The digits of this claw were widely spaced, and I could see where the creature's claws had actually dug into the trunk of the tree. Humphreys, who's an expert tracker, and McDonald both agreed this claw mark wasn't made by a bear or a cat, simply because bears and cats don't grow that large in our part of the world. He said if it had been a bear, it'd have to be the size of a polar bear.
Yeah.
It was clear evidence of a Bigfoot-like monster in our area.
Okay, but all right, but a polar bear is bigger than a Bigfoot.
Later we found a pile of leafy branches piled up beneath a tree at the top of a hill that overlooked the sport. And Brian, you're hung up on Bigfoot. Did I say Bigfoot?
It was a Bigfoot-like monster.
Okay.
In the style of Bigfoot.
Okay, got it. So it's the Alabama knees guy.
Watch that one.
Later we found a pile of leafy branches piled up beneath a tree at the top of a hill that overlooked this wooded bottom. We couldn't tell if anything had been laying on the large pile because we didn't bother looking for hair. But it was odd to find such fresh branches all piled in one place out in the middle of the deep woods. Old man told us that he often hears the creature howling in the woods, and we noted if something were to emit a loud howl from the top of a hill, it would carry for a long way. Perhaps.
Dude.
Miles.
Bigfoot ain't howling. You don't hear howling as Bigfoot.
It's got, you know what? I'm overthinking it. It's the Alabama claw monster, final answer.
No, really. The old man eventually led us back to his house where he showed us his large pit bull named Max Pitbull. It's got everything. The man said that the Bigfoot-like creatures like. Near his home often howl so loud it makes his ferocious dog cower in fear and hide indoors. To be honest, I didn't want to get within 10 feet of this mean-looking dog, so if it's scared of whatever's in those woods, there's probably a good reason. So apparently they found about another incident about a coyote that was found dead 10 feet up in a pear tree. The old man said he'd heard about that, and it actually happened 100 yards from where we were standing. He said that the best way to get there, the back road, runs down beside the house. So let's see if there's any more scanning ad here. Apparently, McDonald, who is an expert land surveyor when he's not hunting Bigfoot, also produced a detailed – and he's got a great carpet tile business – produced a detailed topographical map of the county area and showed the crowd where he'd plotted all the area's Bigfoot sightings. Interestingly, the map showed that most of these reports have concurred in clusters near Burnt Corn Creek and Sepulga River watershed.
God.
All right. So Donald McDonald is an expert a speaker at the Collard Green Festival.
He's an expert surveyor.
He's an
not
expert
Bigfoot
land surveyor.
Hunting.
But his real passion, what he's delivering the goods on, is hunting Bigfoot. Although, like, he used his topographical skills to plot it out.
Like, it's not weird that a pathologist would discover a new virus, you want a Bigfoot hunter to be the one who discovered the
but
next.
But you just know, and they're like, well, how do we trap him?
The next.
Only one thing, collard grease.
Okay. Who do I send a photo to?
Crap. I don't know.
You know what? See who's logged in on that inbox right there on the far right. There you go. To the right. There you go, right there. It looks like send it to scamstuffstore@gmail.com. Our customer feedback is what happens when we logged in. This is what happens when Bryce Neshcom Castillo is not at the helm. We have to jimmy something together
We're jimmying it.
That's right. This is the hey man, it's not our fault. This is the one that happens to be logged in.
And I'm also putting in an order for some stuff.
Well, good. Because we just finished up our mystery bundles.
The deals are so good. How can I resist? All right. So I'm sending you a link here because the photo is a photo. Just he's holding up. It's our Bigfoot researcher. And he's holding up a image of or holding up, actually, I think a print or something like this. But it is the I want you listen. I want to meet this Donald McDonald because he may be my new hero and perhaps a life model for me. And I want you to see the image of the footprint. And right. I guarantee you they had more fun on the Friday the 13th than I did.
All right. So I'm now looking at what Justin's got on the screen. Oh, look at that. Look at that.
All right,
he's
so
a regular. Next up, he's going to be eating scorpions live on the stream.
Dispatches from the LPOP. Killing Bigfoot researchers say there are monsters in Pine Orchard, Alabama. Oh, my
it's
God.
The Alabama claw monster. Tell me. Tell me.
There he is, ladies and gentlemen, holding up his proof.
Oh, God, he's wearing camo. Of course he's wearing camo. Why wouldn't he be wearing camo?
He's like, wearing camo at the Collard Green Festival because it's maybe it's collard green.
Well, because you want to hide among the collard
So here
greens.
We go. This is the claw marks here.
Now, I will say these do not look like the way you would imagine claw marks from a bear. You would picture four scratches, probably finger lengths apart.
I like, Brian, I like in our imaginary naturalist idea of what this would look like.
Well, I mean, I'm just saying it's understandable.
And by the way, here we go. Wearing a Ask Me About Squatch t-shirt. Right here is our man, Donald McDonald, hands on his hip in Peter Pan stance. Just with an S-eating grin on his face. That is our man, baby.
Man.
So the article that linked to here had the name for what this particular monster was apparently called in the area.
Claw monster. Let it be the claw monster.
Are we taking any votes? Any votes?
Justin, what's your final answer?
The Alabama Bigfoot monster.
Oh, no.
The booger monster? Striking Rich?
You're both... Both apparently there have been Sasquatch sightings in 43 of 67 of Alabama's counties. All right, just so you know. But this one, everybody has their own.
Man, why do you suppose Squatches are avoiding those other counties? Like too urban, you think?
So, yeah, well, they just like the open space.
I'm going to tell you, listen, I just realized the best part of this story has been buried because I found an even better name that they have for this at the very end. Because, like, we grew up, Justin, what did we have down in South Florida?
The Skunk Ape, of course, is the famous Florida cryptid.
Yeah, so the name of this thing at the headline is the Alabama Booger Monster.
Oh, my God!
It is!
Somebody got it. Yes, right. Well, Rich had the Alabama
the
Booger Monster.
As we did the thing, which happens with the chat room now. Even better, there's one other name for it, and I hate the chat room for spoiling things, by the way. I hate you guys with a burning hot passion, because part of the fun is trying to make Brian and Justin struggle, and when you're putting answers in front of them...
Look, truth was stranger than fiction in this case.
Oh, yeah.
I would not believe it, Booger Monster.
That was great.
I know. Well, there's one other name for it. There's one other name for it.
Okay.
The Alabama White Thing.
White Thing. You make my heart sing. You slash everything with three claws.
With white three grooves.
I think I love you.
But I want to measure these scars.
Bring you down to the Collard Green Festival.
Oh, you moved me.
I was born in Opelika, Alabama. So, you know, I could be the Alabama White.
You are. That's your new nickname. Ladies and gentlemen, the Alabama White Thing himself, Andrew May.
Apparently the Alabama White Thing has not been spotted near urban areas. It's wrong and it's inappropriate for him to have boundaries like that.
Oh, my God. That was amazing. What a journey.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
That was amazing, man.
Man, I don't even know what else that we could say about the Alabama White thing, except if you want to make sure that we continue to keep doing amazing stuff like this, you can of course support us at patreon.com/weirdthings. That is where you can make sure that we are here and making these episodes. By the way, went over 500 an episode. Thank you guys.
Huzzah!
So much. Although, by the way.
That is a landmark moment.
What the next patron, is our YOLO 420 patron.
Wait, oh my God, because we have 419
patrons.
We have
419.
I thought we were going to name a monster after him. We'll find the YOLO 420 monster.
The YOLO 420 a patron. It could be you. If you like the show, want to support us, then head on over there, patreon.com/weirdthings. And thank you to everybody who does and has continued to do it.
I'm kind of looking forward to us hitting 666.
Oh, yeah.
That would be it. That's a good goal.
There was a hot minute before Patreon rejiggered the way they calculated stuff because they corrected it, basically. They were overcounting some stuff. And there was a hot minute that we were at 666. But that's the next thing to
getting
shoot
there
for.
Natural. Getting there natural.
Rolling natural sixes, three.
So,
it took a lot out of you, the white thing. Huh?
I got another one here. I think like every episode we do a lot of like Elon Musk news and stuff, because when it comes to tech and stuff like that, he's all over. So we're not gonna do that. He's got another launch coming up in a couple weeks where they may try reusable and like the Falcon Heavy, whatever. But we're just sticking it to weird things, okay?
Well, yeah. But hey, real quick, he did announce like they're done with anything but reusables from now on, right?
They have one more non-reusable rocket they're going to launch, and then it's every rocket, even the rockets they don't reuse, they're all going to be the ones built for reusability. So like block
Henry Ford action.
About him, he has what he calls like Falcon 9 Block 5, which is the final version of the Falcon 9 rocket before they do, after that, he says they're going to kind of just lock down the design. And then the whole Falcon rocket design team goes to work on
the MCT, right?
Yeah, the Interplanetary Transport System. So like legit, the whole SpaceX team starts working on the rocket, the Starship that takes us to.
So people, actually, it will be somebody's job. Somebody's going to wake up, on a Monday morning. Maybe they had a few too many glasses of wine the night before. They're gonna
the mariachi party.
Exactly, they're gonna be a little hungover, and they're going to have a crappy Monday working on the spaceship that will take humans.
He's the Dunkin' Donuts guy. Wakes up, he's like, "Time to build the interplanetary fleet."
Yeah,
and then off he goes.
That's amazing.
He's in a bar, and he's like sitting next to some guy who's like, having a toast. It's like, what do you celebrate? Like, I just put together a new end cap display at Walmart. Pretty cool about it. I got all those Campbell's soup things.
Traffic's
there.
Up 20%, bro.
Gave me a little bonus there, a little $50 bonus for drinking it. Like, yeah, what did you do?
Yeah, you ever watch Battlestar Galactica?
Yeah, I built a spaceship so your children cannot die in the eventual heat death of Earth.
Turn to the left. What'd you do? Podcasted.
I talked about the spaceship.
We talked about the Alabama White thing.
Hey man, we know our place in this hierarchy. Somebody's providing for society.
All of a sudden, he's got a smile on his face. Goes back to work with a spring and a stab. He's like, at least I'm not those losers.
Making people happy, feeding the children. That's what I do.
Oh my God, making these things as white as possible.
We're not going to talk about that or SpaceX anything like that.
No.
Let's talk about some madman who says he plans to start digging tunnels under Los Angeles starting in the next couple of months.
Well, hold on. That's implying that there's not a... Look, I watched Weeds. There's tunnels all over the place. That's why walls don't work.
Los Angeles, Brian?
Oh, San Diego. It was San Diego in there.
Yeah. So, no, this is in... So, some lunatic...
Some madman, crazy supervillain has said that they've planned.
No, it's Mayor Garcetti wants to make tube technology. Is that my guess? That's my guess.
No.
Wait, do you not know this?
Nope.
Really?
I think he's coyly describing an initiative to build subways under. See, this is, I think everything's natural.
Maybe they could involve subways, but let's say it's not exactly a government plan.
No,
it is a rogue individual has said that they plan to start investing in technology and the capability to start digging massive, huge tunnels all over Los Angeles because, quote, make this up something. Having to drive around in cars is exhausting and frustrating. And the future is that we have to be driving underground and moving stuff through there. This madman has a lot of business ventures that he has to travel between.
This person got frustrated in LA traffic and decided that the new thing that they were going to do.
Is this person a director?
He directs a lot of stuff.
A director. Yeah. Okay. This isn't another Elon Musk thing after that setup, is it?
What thing?
You make my heart sing.
Ah, dang it, Elon. What are you doing, man? The problem is...
The thing is, I'm kind of I lost words here. So, you know, because we're in an age where we don't know how to process what our president says.
Yeah.
We don't know how to process what our media says.
Yeah.
And when a billionaire who, you know, on one hand is talking about playing Overwatch late at night on Twitter and then shows up at his car factory where he's building, you know, my self-driving robot cars, which would drive to your house, and my spaceship project, is then talking about giant tunneling machines. And we're like, I don't know. Is this real life? I don't know what to believe or not.
I mean, here's the brilliance is that, and you know, he's sort of like the high technology Kreskin, where it's like they'll remember the hits, they'll forget the misses. Let's do a little cold reading here. Let's just throw some ideas out. What's going to stick? Mars. You like Mars?
He's the real deal, though. He actually does.
He's doing it. Yeah. So the news here is that, and also big week for Elon Musk, not only obviously with the stuff with SpaceX, but also the National Highway Transportation Safety Administration vindicated autopilot in their review of the big crash that
the first fatality
tragically led to a man losing his life, said that not only did the guy have 7 seconds to do something, which is in their opinion enough that he could have turned the wheel or hit the brakes, also in their research, autopilot reduced fatalities by 40%.
Holy cow!
That's reduced accidents rather by 40%, which is the first time that figure has been put out there in black and white by a government agency that isn't Tesla themselves. And now, because he's Elon Musk, it's like no, not like one of those. Let's just let 2 months go by before I just start talking about random other stuff on Twitter. He's out here saying, "Yeah, I play a Soldier 76 in Overwatch," and also,
I mean,
had the following news about his tunneling.
In his defense, Soldier 76 does a very balanced offensive character. It's got, I mean, it's like
very
it's
rational. Very,
yeah, exactly.
Here's the quote. So The Verge was asking him, because people are like, wait, are you serious about this? And they got him to DM them, and he said, without tunnels, we will all be in traffic hell forever. He says, I really do. I love because he writes like he talks.
Yeah.
I really do think tunnels are the key to solving urban gridlock. Being stuck in traffic is soul destroying. Self-driving cars will actually make it worse by making vehicle travel more affordable.
Well,
so,
okay, all right. So think about this. Los Angeles is a beating human heart, and you have the circulatory system of traffic, right? And right now we've got blockages. We got dumb cells that are crashing into each other and creating these little miniature strokes all over the place. We have already started to alleviate that problem with Waze. Waze at least routes these red blood cells around the right spots. You go a longer way, but you keep moving the entire time, and it frees up bandwidth, you know, the some of the space for the other red blood cells. Self-driving cars will do even more of it, but if you want to expand, there's only two directions you can go. You can either start flying everywhere, and I think it's pretty clear that people are way uncomfortable with the idea of sky cars and traffic running all around. And I think he's right. I think it's, ultimately, if you have the resources, if somebody says it's $100 billion for everyone to fly everywhere or $200 billion for everyone to take tunnels everywhere, I think people in general would say, well, I'd rather the world spent $200 billion on tunnels because they're going to be quiet. I'm not going to have to hear it. It's going to be all around. And it's not like we have constant earthquakes that are going to put their lives in jeopardy.
Wait, what?
Oh, well, except for the last one. But I think everything I said was reasonable up until that very good reason.
I mean, Elon Musk points out that the earthquakes in California, they're on the surface. They're not kind of like the deeper ones you get in the eastern part.
Sure.
Like one of the things that makes earthquakes different here than they are on the east is like we're still kind of a cake that's still sort of gooey, you know, where eastern seaboard's different. So an interesting thing, I just did a little internet sleuthing, which is really just typing in a URL, but I'll give myself credit.
I like your term, the Alabama sleuthing monster.
I was kind of curious, like the Boring Company, like has this been, because that's what he says that he wants to start is the Boring Company.
Yeah.
And when you go to theboringcompany.com, without the high-pitched end, you see what looks like a real, like, site for real company. Like, a real – you're like, oh, well, this looks real, and geez.
Theboringcompany.com?
Yeah, theboringcompany.com. Of course – when you look a little bit more closely, you realize this is just a dummy webpage that was thrown up very quickly because I don't think 1-800-123-4567 is actually their number.
Oh, and double sleuthing. This is why he's the Sherlock of live podcast deduction.
When you read the testimonials from a Mark Gregaros, it says, dummy text is that text used in the publishing industry or web designers to occupy the space, which will later be filled with real content. This is required when, for example, the final text is not yet available.
Oh, look, they got some lorem ipsum there.
Yeah.
Intro video about company, what we do.
So when we look at
Scooter Libby. Scooter Libby is, wait, isn't that from politics?
Yeah. No, Scooter Libby was
David Boies is the attorney. This was created on May 12th, the registration. So May 12th, 2012.
You think he just parked it and has been sitting on this idea for a while?
I don't know. I mean, because we don't even Elon Musk thinks that he's not up late at night buying up GoDaddy domains.
When he's not playing Overwatch, I'm sure that's what he's up to.
So he says that he plans in the next few months to start over at SpaceX headquarters digging. Now, we've all had experience here with both going to people we work with and having people we work for coming to us with, hey, I had an idea.
Yeah. Man, I used to have one boss that was just constant. It was like every other day. It was just another totally disconnected from the last thing we were doing idea.
So anyway.
Right there. Imagine you're SpaceX, you're Gwynne Shotwell, head of SpaceX, and you've had like, you're sitting there like, you know, she's the one that runs this great, amazing engineer, whatever, you know, and you're like, you're in the break room talking to like the CFO, like, oh, remember when Elon talked about electric airplanes and we had to talk him out of that? Like, Hyperloop got out of control. That got out of control. We couldn't stop that, but we put that out on somebody else. Yeah, we got to let some people use some space here. Well, the electric airplane, but you know, the plans for it are amazing. Like, oh, I know. And she points towards the window and there's the factory floor. They're building rockets. But like, we're still working on this, okay?
Yeah.
And Elon's like, hey, guys, I had an idea. It's like a chill throughout the room.
I know.
It like the first day of work when they heard about his ideas, it's the most awesome thing in the world. And now that this is multi-billion-dollar company, the American Defense Department, NASA's relying on, is like, here's my idea. And they're like, okay, I hope this is like a way to save money on the fuel strut or something, or something like,
please be relevant. Please be relevant. Please be relevant.
We're aerospace company. Airplanes, we had to talk them out of that because it's not space. Hyperloop was engineering. Okay, what is it, Beyond? Well, it's boring. Little Elon Musk smile.
Oh, Jesus.
You know, well, it's boring. Okay. No, literally, we're going to dig tunnels. I've already got the people in Warehouse 3 working on this right now.
So he says that he hopes to be digging within a month. Like, what does that even... What is that process even, right? Like,
testing, right?
You make a hole.
What's that?
You make a hole, then you make it bigger.
Yeah, but no, but I would imagine, you know, digging means, you know, we started our test things and we're building, you know.
But even the process of, like, you know, because when, Boston went through that whole big dig thing where, and that was like 15 years or something, like some ridiculous amount of time to dig a few tunnels to alleviate their traffic. I would wonder even, like, what is the regulatory hurdles to dig massive consumer tunnels?
I would imagine they're substantial, but the thing that we speculated on before is that he probably and his engineers looked at existing tunneling technology and think that they can make improvements. And considering they did that with finance, transportation, and aerospace, I would think that, yeah. not that I know how competitive the world is with mining equipment.
If you've already played in the arena with like Lockheed Martin and Boeing, then, you know, I think you're pretty well equipped to go into any entrenched market, right?
Well, and that's just it, right? It's like that's what Elon Musk does, is he looks at the world and he says, where are inefficiencies? Why are those inefficiencies there? What resources would you have to crush these inefficiencies and do things as if you would with a blank slate, starting from scratch without our previous, like it's as though he's immune to the sunk cost fallacy. Everything is a blank slate to him at all times.
Yeah, I think he looks forward. I mean, there are a lot of things he doesn't go into, and they're businesses that they don't do because they don't think they can find efficiencies there. But yeah, I think that, it's like, now I'm going to dig tunnels. It's like, yeah, I believe you.
Sounds legit.
Believe you.
Obviously. He's a fairly remarkable person, and
He ain't no Alabama white thing. Don't get me wrong.
White thing.
So, quick question: we've been making some rapid developments in our ability to add in DNA to give people to actually rewire your DNA, etc. We're starting to find certain genes that are attached to intelligence. In fact, researchers have found they've been able to take mice and monkey with their DNA. They did not actually use that term in their paper, but actually flip a switch in the brain of rodents that turned them into killer mice.
Okay. On the one hand, I guess it makes
sense. And this
didn't
even involve genetics. The mice became aggressive predators when two sets of neurons in the amygdala were activated with laser light. Lasers. Oh. The animals became very efficient in hunting.
Man, is this just like a Zootopia thing?
They pursue the prey, a live cricket, faster, and they're more capable of capturing and killing it. The animals intensively bite the toy and use their forepaws in an attempt to kill. They'll attack inanimate objects even.
I mean, that's impressive, but one time on the Galaga machine, the assistant manager had wired an extra lead to the screws on the outside, so all you had to do is take your keys and touch the two screws, and it would put a credit in there.
Brian, you should be getting some sort of engineering prize. You should be working for space. You should be the guy that, like, hey, your boring idea, Elon, go talk to Brian.
Yeah.
You're in this room filled with cardboard models.
I'm on it, boss.
How's the new thruster working on, bro? It's great. It's great. You pull up, like, is this a Folgers coffee can?
It's like, you know these ridges on there? They give a structural reinforcement, Elon.
It's like, walks back out. All right, guys, very funny. So my question for you is, like, we're learning these sort of, now, by the way, that's also like kind of like the plot of Terminal Man, though, is like the pacemaker in the guy's head that turned psycho.
Yeah, the first of the Brilliant Idea, But Everything Went Wrong books from Michael Crichton.
Would you guys, like, if somebody said, like, hey, we've got a new DNA technique thing that, like, increased your IQ by about 20 points, and no, you will not become a sociopath?
Well, I mean, we already, to a certain extent, not so much for IQ, but for what we think of as core personality traits, we have pharmacological modifiers. Like, if you think in video game terms, we have, you know, Buff Out and Jet and all the drugs from Fallout in the form of Adderall and so on, like actual performance enhancing drugs. I would imagine that technological, you know, biological enhancements can't be that far behind, right?
Yeah, I think that if it was an area of actual research to do it, I think that we would probably be there. And that's one of the things that's going to be interesting to see. And one of the frustrations for a lot of Silicon Valley people, a lot of new tech people, is that, you know, the FDA or the Center for Disease Control will call guns a disease epidemic, but they won't say that aging is.
Right.
And that, you know, we should maybe start looking into the idea of, like, no, like, literally, there are these areas that could make us improved. Why don't we consider attacking those? And so if you wanted to make people more intelligent, wanted to be able to do that stuff, like, yeah, I think if you had the you know, the capability to do that, then why not? I mean, would you
keep in mind, like, there's a bunch of different techniques, right? And whether they happen to be pharmacological, physiological, or educational, methodological, you know, like, think about the Flynn effect, the fact that every 10 years we have to reset the IQ scale because the average human today would be a genius by 1950s standards. And that's not just because we have the internet and we know stuff. It's because we learn stuff at a faster rate. We learn to problem solved. We learn the heuristics. We think more logically. We're just flat out smarter now than at any point in all of human history. And that is only going to get better as, you know, boring stuff like tunnels under the ground, boring stuff.
Well, let's qualify the Flynn effect too. I'd say that we are better at the kinds of measures that it measures because the things that it measures our culture sort of accelerates towards, you know, and that we don't actually, like, have, you know, if we could probably find other measures that we wouldn't do as well as somebody who, you know, 1,000 years ago in some regards.
Yeah, that's tough to say because then you're getting into redefining what we culturally have accepted to mean intelligence, right? If we want to pivot on what the word intelligence means, then yeah, I'm sure you could point to, I'm sure our, I don't know, maybe our emotional intelligence is better nowadays.
Long form recall. Things like that, which I don't know, but I'm saying, like, there are sort of firms, things that weren't as scored so highly on IQ tests.
Sure, but like for example, culturally, at no point in human history has more of humanity been aware of the presence of false memories and therefore able to compensate for it, right? So that is a structural society-wide change that has made us a superior life form to us 300 years ago when we all thought that eyewitness testimony was worth a damn or whatever. You know,
man,
what I mean?
You're assuming that word got around to everybody.
well, and it hasn't, right? Like, only, let's say only 2% of humanity has gotten the word yet, but still being, you know, that 2% being more aware of that thing and it being written down and keep in mind, you know, all of medicine is essentially 150 years old, basically germ theory and so on. Like, these are structural advancements. If you play, again, I keep thinking of video games like Sid Meier's Civilization, you know, you unlock these technologies that change society forever, and barring some apocalypse, you don't go back.
Do we need like three different kind of, like, one would be like kind of like intelligence aptitude, another one would be knowledge, and then the third domain would be information processing? Because I would argue that one of the problems that frustrates us, we talk to other people, is that we know a lot of really smart people with a lot of good, you know, knowledge, but they're not critical thinkers. They're not good at information processing, and they don't understand there's this thing that needs to happen between, your raw brain and the information out you in this processing. And I hear a lot of people screaming fake news who are really into fake news that supports what they want to believe. And right. It's kind of like, yeah, no, it's not just what's being said. It's how you process what's being said, or it's not which facts you choose to believe. It's how you approach them, you know?
Well, and that's the problem. I've certainly been guilty of knowing a fact, having somebody tell me it wasn't true, Googling the fact, finding the first article that looked like it confirmed it, and be like, read this. I'm pretty sure that's the thing I read a long time ago. And then they're like,
such a dismissive tossing of a website.
No, that's the new iOS read this gesture. But then, of course, you know, it turns out that it's like, whoops, should have actually read the article, should have actually looked at the source. Now I look dumb.
It's the hard part is that my friends who love science and I talk about critical thinking really don't often, and not to say, oh, I get it. But I would say that, like, I think an idea that the three of us entertain is we assume we know from our own point of view, there's no such thing as certainty. We do not believe in personal certainty.
I don't want to be that smug group of magicians, but I think being from the world of magic causes you, when you spend your whole life fooling people and watching them be fooled and watching them misremember what they saw, chasing after the high of getting fooled again, you know, you realize like, I could be wrong. Like all the time about everything.
My magic friends are just as idiotic as everybody else and believe just as many stupid things.
I want to put you in a time capsule and send you back in time so you can talk to you when the Magic Cafe was lighting you on fire for exposure.
to explain
how enlightened and amazing the
Well, this and actually this is no BS. This is why I feel like it is morally and educationally important for critical thinking for everyone not to read about how a magician fooled another person, although I think stuff like the Alpha Project is great, I think is to actually perform the act of deceiving other people so that you recognize those patterns in your own mind about yourself. When I was the victim of the shortchange crime, which is a full-on crime, I didn't know what was happening, but I had the just gut instinct. This feels like
something's
a magic
weird.
Trick.
Yeah.
Yeah, this feels like a magic trick. There's process. I'm being guided.
I'm going to make the argument, Brian, though, that you're a guy that was already wired for that kind of inquiry kind of thing. Because of the problem I had in working and like trying to teach magic and critical thinking stuff is, one, we learned that some of the most gullible people I ever met were magicians, because they'd go like, no, I know how magic works. And this was real. I mean, like, look at the magicians who are like, oh, here you go. You should give them a shot. Like, well, you don't know his history, you know, like, oh, well, what do you do? It's like, yeah, this guy threatened to sue me. Little history there. But then it's like, and then magicians like, oh, no, this I know. That's not a trick. And it's like, OK, you have a little bit of knowledge, but you learned the wrong thing. You learned that if I know how this works, the lesson you took was, this is how the brain works. Unfortunately, I would say that most magicians and psychologists, and a lot of people, they also get this false sort of expertise thing, like, ah, now I know how not to be fooled.
Yeah. Yeah. Or they're like, well, it can't be that because I already learned that trick and it's not, and I know all about that.
You're right. The lesson is there. You're absolutely right. The lesson is there. But I just see people just look right past the lesson and go, now I, and it's like, No, the lesson is we're fooled. You can be fooled, and people don't want to, if you don't want to admit or accept that you can be fooled, then you're going to keep getting, if you want to believe like, no, I can tell that it's like real news. I know this thing.
And furthermore, like the low grade assertion at all times that you're probably wrong about everything. Like that is so highly uncomfortable for anyone. Like it's, I think we've talked about this metaphor I had before. It's like, you know, it's like the superposition in quantum theory. It's like we want it to be one or the other. We hate the idea that it's both and neither. And so you know, whatever it takes to massage in our brain, it's wires, it's candy glass, it's whatever, you know.
And I would argue that the three of us and many of our listeners are uncomfortable with the idea of certainty. When we hear certainty, arguments, subtle, these other things, that to us is like, ooh, no, because we've been on both sides of issues and stuff and learned like when I hear people, my friends who love science, using the same phrasing that I heard from young earth creationists and people who denied evolution in the 90s and stuff, when I would get into arguments, when I hear these same sort of arguments from, you know, authority and these other stuff, I'm like, it makes me feel sick. I'm like, no, this is not this is not how we work. This is not how a rational person works.
I guess you probably see that in your politics, politics, politics podcast all the time, where there's some stuff that is factual that can be debated. But then you hear all the time, like, the green team hates the yellow team because their guy came from this place and told this lie that time.
Yellow team sucks,
Brian. But it's okay when the green team does it because, well, he's just saying what needs to be said to get important green legislation out.
Well, I mean, you know, it was in a lot of ways the reasons why I was critical, and this was more on Daily Tech News Show than politics, but I was very, very critical of the Facebook fake news initiative, because they were using, and I think that there are great resources like PolitiFact and everything, but really they're not there to tell you whether or not something is true or not. They are there to very specifically, like, slice the politics speak to find out whether something is closer to 90% true or closer to 10% true, you know, because normally there's always a kernel of something, and that is either blown up beyond proportion or something else. But it's like, that's really where a lot of that cognitive, like, you know, just hold on to like, okay, well, yeah, well, now I'm going to focus on that. If it's 50-50, all right, there was something that was definitely true that now you are deliberately playing down the skeptical elements of and saying, well, this is a fact. Then both sides can say, yeah, that's true. Look at that. That's a thing. And that's the problem that we get ourselves into.
Yeah, it's frustrating. And that comes from, you know, and there was a rather ironic tweet from a famous person who said something about, like, you know, what we should, you know, what I want to live in a world where, you know, facts determine our views and not vice versa. And this happened to be said by somebody who for a very long time at our amazing meeting actually said a totally inaccurate thing that a president said, made it up, and then would not admit it for weeks and weeks that it was a fabricated quote. It's like, well, you're telling us this? You know, so,
well, I mean, but again, that's dangerously close to falling into the trap of, like, well, you're a yellow team guy.
Well, and this person's telling us this is how the thing when caught, refused to admit, you know, that it's one thing to be wrong. It's nothing to deny that one. It's one thing to make something up, get caught making it up, and then to lie about making it up or whatever. And you're like, oh, well, OK, why? And you're credible to us. Why?
Yeah. Well, and you know, the greatest thing that you can ever do is wake up every day and say, I am really dumb. And I hope that I can end the day slightly
smarter,
less dumb than I am right now.
I am. You know what else is dumb?
What?
What may be happening to Brian Justin on Journey Quest.
Oh,
Journey
damn.
Quest, our post-apocalyptic, never-ending journey out to the West Coast to hopefully find a living Andrew Main. I believe at this last moment, Justin and I were driving into... Oh, no, we definitely played Flight of the Valkyries, killed a lot of people
Ride
who were planning a birthday party for me.
Ride of the Valkyries.
No, I think you said Ride of the Valkyries during it, and then Bryce looked it up, and it came up Flight of the Valkyries, but I don't know. You know what? I could be wrong.
Why that? all right. So, Brian, this time I decided to give Brian the full decision-making power. He was just following orders.
how did that work out?
We murdered a lot of people. We've effectively leveled Diamond City.
I mean, we basically accomplished, mission accomplished, right?
Well, we were there up on the orders of Overlord Neshcom.
Awesome.
Commander Awesome, Admiral Awesome. So we killed everybody in Diamond City when we thought we were under attack. As it turned out, they were just firing T-shirts at us and celebrating your birthday. But what did we get for our all of our hard work? It seems as if Bryce came in on a helicopter and triggered the explosive necklaces that he had placed on us before we left to accomplish his dirty deeds. We left our heroes as Bryce had hit the button and our necklaces were starting to beep. Andrew, what happens?
All right, so your necklaces are beeping. You're like, this is not good. And you look up and Bryce is flipping you off from the helicopter.
Eating scorpions, okay. Fistfuls of scorpions left and right.
Right?
Jerk.
And all of a sudden, you hear, like, B-sides from Boys to Men start to play through your collar. Right? Okay. Look up. You see Bryce hitting his remote control. Very, very angry. Very upset that it's not doing what it's supposed to do. Throws it. Hits the helicopter pilot in the back of the head. The control stick lunges forward. And the helicopter starts to spiral. Goes back over the hill towards Diamond Town. And there's an explosion.
Dude, I think we better get in this war rig and ride on over and see what's on the other side of that hill.
Pour the wine, light the candle.
Also, I put my thumb over the speakers.
Oh, man.
I chew some bubble gum and try to stick it over the speakers to quiet.
I'll make love to you.
Like
you want me to.
So you hop back into the war rig, you start it up. But because of all the explosions and everything else, the ground beneath you is a little bit kind of unsettled. And you're like, you hit the accelerator, and the next thing you know, you drop like 20 feet.
Oh, geez. Are we trapped in a sinkhole
now inside of an underground lair.
Oh, tunnels. Only a crazy person would dig tunnels under Diamond City.
And I will not let go.
Ah, now there's an echo. What's going on? Ah.
Ela, your headlights hit this man standing there in a mad scientist uniform, and immediately your arm goes into a Sieg Heil.
Oh, jeez.
I scan him with my Adolf. Tell me about this guy.
And it says, and it's like the little girl from Full House voice goes, he's a real cool dude.
Like, Justin, I think this guy's bad news.
And Paul's to that in the chat room just says, will nothing go right?
We're going to find out. He's like, gentlemen, so glad you could come speak to me again. I'm glad you've welcome to my lair.
Okay, so this is the same guy that gave Brian Nazi superpowers, right? Yeah. All right.
I mean, it doesn't look like anything
Nazi
to me.
Superpowers. You might be reading way more into that.
I mean, it's like, look, I mean, it's factual that I'm stronger and faster.
And more
and
sympathetic.
I would never call
No, goodness, no. But I mean, it's like I got this friend in my mind who handles a lot of my Siri, you know. But Adolf.
Oh, we don't really ask him a lot of questions, you know. It's like,
all right, Adolf, I want you to scan the area and tell me if there are any other friends of this gentleman.
There's a henchman, you know, this is what you call a lab assistant in the post-apocalyptic days, standing over on this old-looking computer system, this thing looks very like primitive, like it's got levers and dials, it's making a click, 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 click sort of sound.
Okay.
And he looks over and sees you and says, did you like the Quiznos?
All right. Number one, yes, the Quiznos was quite delicious. That was a fine moment.
He's eating another fresh Quiznos sandwich.
Well, hold on. Do you have another Quiznos? As long
as it's the last one.
Okay. I mean, do you want to split halfsies on it?
Nope. You'll have to get
okay,
your
all own. Right. Okay. Can I have just a moment to talk to my friend Justin?
Yeah. Sure, carry on. You're not going anywhere.
All right, look. I mean, granted, we're wearing collars playing Boys to Men. We're in an underground lair in the belly of the beast, but I got a little voice in my head that says it's only this guy and one doodly doo. Do you think we could take him? We got all these weapons. We could press a bunch of buttons on the war rig.
Okay. How about we don't immediately yet again?
This guy's a Nazi, though.
Okay, I mean, number one, if we're gonna start like,
I'm
know,
a Nazi.
See, he even admits it.
Okay.
No, I mean, who are you to call?
Yeah.
Oh no! Oh goodness, no!
You are the Fist of Aryan Power.
Okay, look, you want to see what the Fist of Aryan Power can do to the creator of the Fist of Aryan Power? You ever watch a little movie called Frankenstein? Come on, man! I'm Frankenstein's monster. Let's tear this MF-er down.
Okay. Can we at least try to get some information out of him before you tear him limb from limb?
You know what? I step
you
back.
You start doing...
I hold my palms up. I start bobbing up and down on the balls of my feet.
Here.
I start shadow boxing in the background.
All right. Just give me 100 burpees.
Okay, I do. I start doing 100 burpees.
All right. I go over to Mad Scientist.
It's like, yes, you know, we did not program in the Führer into this thing.
Seven.
He would not shut up about Call of Duty when we were trying to do the procedure on him.
Yeah. As it turns out, the AI takes the form that you of the person you most admire.
Apparently, yes.
Most people, it's Martin Luther King.
All right.
I'm going to show you video. We even captured the way he sees things. And weird, it looks like Castle Wolfenstein.
Okay, all right, look, I was a big fan. My brother worked on the bad guy.
You play as the good guy. We don't understand this.
All right, you're not even in double-digit burpees. All right, hey.
25.
You have to mod the game to be the Nazi in Castle Wolfenstein.
All right, mad scientist, what are you doing under Diamond City? What relationship do you have with Diamond City?
I'm trying to save the world.
From what?
From what? The apocalypse.
Oh, okay. From the apocalypse, you're a little late, Gunter.
Hold on. Let me have another fresh Quiznos sandwich like my
henchman. Oh, you liar! You lying sack of baggage! I immediately push past him and look and see if there's any other Quiznos. And I start muttering under my breath. I say, Adolf, I swear to God, you scan for every Quiznos in this laboratory.
I got them from this box. He points to what looks like kind of like the toaster from Brian's show that he used, right? There's all sorts of gauges and dials and all sorts of other things inside of there that, like, it just looks a very steampunk looking kind of thing. Nazi steampunk, we'll be honest, okay? You know, it's the Zertosten Guten is what it's called there.
All right.
It's like, it's got actually a Nazi logo on there, the swastika on a toaster. Right.
I use my fingernail to kind of pick away at the logo and try to make it into the letter T or something. T for team unity, like, and all right, we're all
hold on
the...
Hold on. Let me ask a question. What is your favorite food?
I don't know, bell peppers.
Fast food, please.
It's Quiznos, fine.
Quiznos. What's? I'm gonna take an order here. You, Justin, what do you like?
I like Taco Bell.
Okay, all right, very good. He takes like a CB radio set from the side of the walk from the toaster and says, one Quiznos order. Brian, so what do you want?
Lots of bell peppers, salt and pepper. No mayonnaise.
Which do you want? Do you want a turkey combo? Do you want the spicy Italian?
A turkey add bacon, yeah, please.
Okay, turkey bacon with lots of bell peppers. Lots of bell peppers,
yeah.
Oh, they don't have any bell peppers. They're out of bell peppers.
You know what? I'll just do it.
You know what? You know what?
Soup.
I will call back in a week. He flips a dial and says, okay, do they have bell peppers now? Okay, very good. Bell peppers. Excellent. Justin, what do you want from Taco Bell?
I've changed my mind. Now I want to go to Wendy's. I want a spicy chicken sandwich, no mayonnaise.
Spicy chicken sandwich, no mayonnaise. Okay, we can do this. Like, yes, no. Go to 1983 because it'll be cheaper then. Very good. Okay, click. Hangs up. Says, okay, one moment. I mean, it happens instantaneously, but, you know, those ding, ding, ding. Opens up the toaster. Pulls out fresh Brian. He smells the melty cheese. Do you like that?
Yeah. All right. Just give it to me. I use my super speed to snatch it out of his fingers real fast.
Hands it to you. It says, Justin, here's your Wendy's sandwich.
I finished the rest of my 100 burpees while eating the sandwich one-handed.
Ooh, and look, Nachos Extreme for me, which they only made in 1997.
Oh, ask him if he's. Hey, can you go back to 1999 and get those brief time that oh boy, Oberto's made beef jerky chips? They were like potato chips, only they were made of beef jerky.
Where was that? At Kroger or Food Lion?
No. It was everywhere. It was during that brief Adkins craze.
Fine. Because of the walkie-talkie. I need
pizza flavored. The Italian flavored.
Pizza flavored. All right. And was this at a store near you?
It was like at Circle K. So yeah.
The Circle K. Okay. It's one moment.
That's the one moment that gets me.
Opens it up. There they are.
All right. I wolf them down. I taste them. And then I proceed to do the rest of my burpees with both hands full of food.
No, I just imagine Brian opens up the Oh Boy Alberto beef jerky chips, takes a bite of one, and just looks up and goes, it's pure.
Yeah, I bite the chip tip and I spit it out because it's clearly poison. I go, I'm like, it's real.
All right, wizard, what's your game here?
It's no game, only science. Nazi science, but science nonetheless.
Okay, gosh. All right, so how committed are you guys to this Nazi part of your Nazi science?
It's just a joke we make around here. We're no Nazis here.
Oh, well, that's convenient.
Good. There's
National Socialists.
Oh, God. Oh, man. God, he's got Harambe'd. What the hell is that? all right. Look, what's your game, boss? What do you say you're looking to save the world? What's wrong with the world, and how can you fix it?
What is right with the world right now, other than 99% of the population's dead? Are you happy with that? Are you glad that certain peoples are dead?
Okay,
are you?
No. I want everybody to live and thrive and survive. I want us to be all interconnected and be as free as possible with as much prosperity as possible. Is that what you want?
Yeah.
Okay, hey, so what do you want to do about it, huh? All right, because we're living here in the post-apocalypse. You've gone and Nazi'd up my friend and given him crazy powers.
He did that to himself. He modded himself.
All right, fine. So you brought out his latent Nazi loving.
Hey, let's just put a pin in that discussion altogether, all right? Can we just get back?
So what's your deal? Apparently you're time-traveling sandwiches through the space-time continuum. What's going on here?
I've built a bigger one.
Wait, like big enough for two.
Well, right now you're sending stuff from the past to the future. Can you send stuff from the future to the past?
Yeah.
Okay.
Have you tried to do it yet?
No. I need two volunteers.
All right. Well, I don't want to go in all willy nilly. Okay. I walk over and using my super strength, I rip out the two chairs from the front of the war rig, and I grab a Sharpie and I draw a face on them both, and I label one Brian and one Justin, and then I hand them and I say, "Can we put these in the machine and send them back to 1982?"
Why would you do that?
I don't know. It's a test, just to see.
No, we got to Bill and Ted this.
Oh, wait.
We got to send something back or somebody back that's going to put a thing on our person.
Oh, like, no, this is a great idea.
That if this works, all right. Then we're going to go back and we're going to put the key to that door that we have never seen before
right.
in our... And in my shoe.
Okay, hold on, real quick. Where does this thing put stuff? I guess it goes back in time. Can it go anywhere in space as well?
Yeah, within 200 or 300 miles.
Okay, but it could send it back here, right?
But in theory, the problem is that it's not accurate, and anything big we use, we've never tried it with anything big to go back in time.
All right, but.
It's a one-way trip.
So it sounds like it's pretty safe to go. You just don't know where you'll end up.
Well, we've never actually sent anybody back in time. And we think that if we try it, it may not work a second time.
Oh, well then...
And pardon my accent. I spent time in Russia after...
Wait, are you also a Soviet?
My mother was East German. My father was from Ukraine. I split the difference to make them both happy.
White thing.
All right, so we gotta. I mean, are we gonna go in this thing or not? Because we have a chance to go back in the past and figure out. Because we don't even know what caused this apocalypse.
Do you know what causes apocalypse?
Apocalyptic causes. I have serious.
Well, what's your? All right, if we're gonna go back, we gotta know why we're going back. What are we doing?
Where did it begin?
There's a research facility. All right, guys, listen. My name is Joe Robertson.
I'm bad at accents.
This is an accent too, actually. I just use this to make you guys, because I realized you weren't trusting the whole Nazi accent thing. So I'm going to talk this way. I'm like, guys, I'm actually a guy who works for a secret agency I can't tell you about.
Okay.
Rhymes with CIA.
Are you with the BIA?
No, it's the DIA.
You're with Denver International Airport.
I said it. Okay. Right. This is why they make me work in a lab. Anyhow, point is, we got this machine. We think it works. We can send you back in time. You tell us when. We think there may have been a lab somewhere outside of Austin where this outbreak started. We want to send a couple guys back in time to go look at it.
All right. And about how far back? When was this lab being created?
I think the lab may have started in the 70s.
So we would have to go back to the 70s?
No, because any time after the 70s, because the lab is there at all times after the 70s. Can you send us back to 1993?
93, yeah, sure.
I mean, I think I know how to blend in there, Justin. And after all, your name is only one letter away from Austin. It seems like we could make this work.
It is true. All right. It seems like this is what we need to do. We need to go undercover and investigate this laboratory to avert the apocalypse.
All right. So you got, okay. So here, follow me. Let's go down the hallway.
Yeah.
Go into another room. It's not a toaster, but it isn't an industrial oven.
You know what? Go big or go home. I just step right on in, eating my Quiznos and my oh boy Umberto. I mean, I'm like, hey man, these are real.
Remember when you were like, you know, this shortchange routine seems like,
you know what?
Time is ticking, gentlemen. All right,
I look at Justin and I say, throw the switch now. While I'm inside and he's not.
I look at Brian and I make a roll the dice motion. because I look at this at our scientist friend and I'm like, he wants us to throw the switch. That's crazy. And just as the door is about to close, I grab the scientist, I throw him in there with us, and I try to, I guess, time the switch to go off so we're all in the oven thing.
Scientist is looking at you both. It's like, it's a dead man switch. One of us has to stand outside and press the button.
All right. Look.
Wait, he has an assistant. I put I make a finger gun and put it against his back.
Yeah, you stick it in your pocket.
And I say, hey, listen here, you Nazi son of a bitch.
Devices. Okay, I will take care of this. Presses a button and Brian starts to strangle you.
Oh dear. I start making
superpowers. Superpowers are so great.
Scientist climbs out of the oven, shuts the door, just gives you guys a funny look, and says, "Okay, is the funniness over? Are we ready to go, gentlemen?"
I mean, it sounds as though some unstoppable authority over our destiny has determined that we have no choice. I guess we might as well go for it.
You already got into the oven. You already committed to that.
All right. Flip the switch.
Also,
Gunter.
Also, real quick, I changed the choke into one of those like rubbing shoulders, hey buddy, kind of moments.
All right, so you science is like, all right, very good. Closes the shutter. It's like, oh, pulls. He reaches under. You hear like he reaches under the oven, pulls something out, and pulls out a saucepan, pushes it out of the drawer. It's like, all right, this is for something else. Don't worry about this. He walks away, and you look through the little window. And it's like, all right, everybody ready? And you're like, you're both pressing your faces like velociraptors against the glass, like waiting to see what's going to happen. And you're like,
puffing,
okay.
Steaming breath.
We let this Nazi scientist talk us into crawling inside of an oven. Mm-hmm. What could possibly go wrong there? And you're like, but this Quiznos still tastes good, and it's Obierto jerky. And then Justin points out to across from the time machine, these big, huge doors. It says FDA government long-term food storage facility.
God damn it.
Wait. What does that
he
mean?
He wasn't going back in time, idiot. He was just like, they had every piece of fast food ever stored in an FDA storage locker.
But no, I mean, it might be that they did send it back in time, but they put it in long-term storage to...
I hate you.
Maybe it's just a one-way radio that he radios that says, put it in the storage, and then it's there. No?
So, next time on Journey Quest, we'll find out what happens if he pulls the switch.
All right.
That's pretty much the end of Journey Quest, right? We've done one of those endings in a Choose Your Own Adventure where the Choose Your Own Adventure starts yelling at you when you flip the page. Like, hey, idiot, what the hell do you think was going to happen?
He's like, go back to the beginning.
Page one. Oh, God damn it. I hate you.
Hey, man, I got a pick. I got a pick.
Pick it up.
That I don't think we've discussed for a while, but I have appeared on this program and in talking about getting smarter and getting less dumb every day made me think of You Are Not So Smart, an entire show, a podcast all about the cognitive biases that we all suffer from. David McRaney is the author of two books, You Are Not So Smart and You Are Now Less Dumb. And we got to meet him at Dragon Con, and he was nice enough to have me on the show. And it's been a lot of fun to watch my 12-year-old science-minded daughter fall in love with the program and work her way back and then discover the episode her dad was on.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah, but it's a really,
really great...
And she
doesn't think the show's cool anymore.
Yeah, right?
Yeah.
And she's like,
yeah, it really jumped the shark.
No, it's really great, and it's all evergreen content. He talks to a lot of different experts, and in fact, like recently, he said, hey, remember 3 years ago when there was this interview? Well, this is in the news, and it seemed relevant, so here's the extra 30 minutes I cut out from that interview. Like, that's how evergreen the content is.
Gotcha.
But really, really great stuff. I like it a lot.
Justin?
I'm going to call my own number on this one. I'm doing a wrestling podcast with Willie Dills Gregory. It's called 1-900-WRESTLING. This is the busy season for that field as the road to WrestleMania begins this weekend at the Royal Rumble. So if you like wrestling, then I highly recommend you go ahead and give it a shot. I'm very, very proud of it. It's a far more irreverent, silly kind of take on... you'd be shocked at how many podcasts about wrestling take it far too seriously. We are not one of them. So go ahead and check it out. 1-900-WRESTLING.
I'm going to dial my own number too. And I have a pick. But my dial my own number here, I'm going to be sending out details about this. It's coming out soon.
You better be a monstrously large book.
Oh my God.
Dude, that is huge. You have an astonishing body of work.
I don't want to brag. I'm holding up a copy of my book. This is all of my illusion books and plans that I put them together in one giant hardback volume. It includes Solo X, Illusion Effects, Illusion Book, Secret Illusion Show, Illusion Tech, How to Levitate, Pocket Sign, and so forth. It is like 650 pages of stuff. Illustrations and all sorts of stuff here. And I finally got the hardcover version today. And I will be sending out details. AndrewMaine.com, sign up for my email list. I have a feeling that people on my email list may get the deal of the century when it comes to this, because it's big and it's a lot. And it's like hundreds of dollars worth of my books and plans all together in one giant.
Real quick, on the off chance that I never did it, I'm going to go to AndrewMaine.com. And then where do I sign up?
To be right up top, right?
First, right there. All right, I'm going to double check. Yeah, it looks like it auto completed. All right, I'm
so
in.
It won't, and I'm like, it's not going to be cheap. I'm gonna put this out there, but it's not going to be.
But also, none of your stuff was, like, all of your stuff were independent volumes that were really good illusion books. As a matter of fact, that was the first contact, the one-way connection I ever had with you, was a friend of mine said, hey, looking at the magic-y stuff, I think you would really like this stuff. And that was when I first read about the Russian roulette with vodka that later showed up on Scam School and stuff. Like, it's all really good stuff with a very practical mindset. None of this pie in the sky, like, imagine this, like, the stuff that's never been built. You could tell every single thing has been tried and done and touched with those gorgeous main hands. I don't know. I'm really excited that you're putting it all in one volume. That's going to be great.
Yeah, I'm excited because the problem I had is that, like, I was keeping some things in print and stuff, you know, but back and forth. But it was kind of a pain to sort of, like, you know, some titles, you know, I still move a lot every year, some don't. But all there, I'm like, I just was afraid of losing them, you know, like, because even trying to track down copies to do this was problematic. And I had this sort of fear of losing it. I'm like, and also the idea of putting together just one big resource of illusions, one sort of stuff that I put out there. And so that was exciting about that. And so the project came together pretty quickly. And it's kind of fun to.
And you know what I just realized looking at it is it reminds me of some of the first magic books that I got in the late 90s that were collections of zines and stuff, like Swami Mantra or the Pallbearers Review or the collected works of Alex Elmsley or stuff like that. Like you're entering the pantheon of great illusion makers who have, you know, these 20, 30 year body of works. And that finally, I mean, like, that's a treasure trove to anybody
who
bothers to dive in.
Andrew, tell them about the picture that you need to take to promote the book.
Oh my God. So when I was a kid, Paul Osborne, who was the first person to actually ever publish one of my illusion plans in one of his books, Paul Osborne was passed away recently, was a big loss to the magic world. He wrote a column that he published illusion plans in Genie magazine on a regular basis, did I think with Magic magazine too. And what he published were these, you know, was the first, how would you build illusions? Illusions in magic, by the way, are what we call kind of like big tricks, like sawing a girl in half or making somebody vanished. And so Paul had put out a lot of those. And then I opened up my copy of like Genie magazine one day, and there is a picture of Paul Osborne. He's like wearing a jean jacket, standing with this like crumpled paper background. It looked really cool. Kind of, that was like a big thing back in the day, like that sort of artsy sort of thing. Mm-hmm. On a table next to him is this big hardback copy of his book, this hardbound book that was all of his Genie illusion plans, right? Like 10 years of plans, you know, so like it was 120 something magic tricks or whatever illusions. And I looked at this and I'm like, this is the coolest thing in the world. And it was, you know, I'm like, this is cool. Like, you know, one day I want to be able to do something like that and look cool standing next to it. And I will never look that cool. But right now, here I am holding my own book. Eugene jacket's on the way.
I know. That's what I'm like, dude, you know, you have to do it, right? Like you have to, sorry, I had that weird gif going.
I gotta find that image. I would like to sort of, you know, do an homage to, you know. Oh.
I think you need to. You need to. Absolutely.
So anyhow, that's my thing. So if you're into magic, you're into that kind of stuff, please check that out. I'll have details probably later this week, early next week about that, and forthcoming. And just a real quick pick, a movie that, it's one of these movies, there's some movies that you go back and you watch, you go, man, this is such a fun, good movie. This is such a really cool thing that, you know, got a certain amount of attention, but maybe wasn't a huge amount, but you're kind of like, this is a thing I like to sort of revisit. And for me, it was Master and Commander.
Oh yeah. That was a great one. It was a simple naval war story set in a period. This is the one with
Russell Crowe.
Yeah, yeah, Russell Crowe. Yeah. It was simple. They said, hey, here's the place, here's the rules.
Yeah,
here's the story. Enjoy.
Yeah, I mean, it was you know, based on this series or something, like I forgot how many novels that came out there. They took some really cool events from there. It's not based on any actual person, but kind of a cool collection of events. Really enjoyed it. Peter Weir directed it, who I always think does pretty cool stuff. So I watched that again, and it just, you know, it starts off with like just a great naval battle. It ends with a great naval battle. I think it's Russell Crowe at his Russell Crowe best. So, you know, big fan. So that was my pick.
Good one. Fantastic movie. One time, a friend of Andrew and I's, Anthony, once took a girl on a first date to that movie. There was no second date. So it might not be the most romantic way to introduce yourself to somebody, but it was certainly a film in which everybody, you know, I think in our ilk would very much enjoy.
Yeah. Gentlemen, it's been weird.
Certainly has.
Hey, so if we're able to roll straightforward, there's a chance I could watch a single episode of Voltron with my daughter before I leave for 10 days.
Wow. What a lot of pressure.
I'm just saying, like, are you feeling the pressure in your bladder? Do we want a bio break?
Yeah, I need
okay, all right, well, here, let's run that, and then we'll try to regroup and keep going in 90 seconds or so.
Jesus, Brian.
Pressure!
A miracle worker.
And we're back.
That music is about the most evil thing you can do to somebody.
Oh, it's so good. So good.
Yeah. For our two people who are left.
Dude, baby metal is the jam. All right, man.
Wait,
we got to do a thing with the guy.
I'm going to delete this.
Wait, hold on.
Have
you saved it?
No, yeah, we're still saving it. That's why it won't let me delete it.
Okay.
Let's not delete our show.
No.
That would be bad. Dumb move. Dumb move from a dumb,
dumb
guy.
Dumb move. Stupid, you bad co-host.
Yeah. I'm trying to find that Paul Osborne image, by the way. Because that would be cool. And I don't know. I mean, I guess I could go to the Magic Castle and start looking through like a billion years of Genie magazines.
All right. We are ready to record in 3, 2.
Welcome to the After Things podcast. I'm Andrew Main, joined by Brian Brushwood.
Man, I'm feeling after. I'm feeling like we want to share all our creative insights of people trying to make it as independent artisans of some variety.
Mm-hmm. Justin Robert Young.
Yes, it's me,
Justin Robert Young.
Gentlemen, you know, being a one of the things about being a creator, besides crying yourself to sleep a lot and the self-loathing, the feeling of inadequacy.
Constant low-grade fear.
Yeah.
Low self-esteem.
You know that weird kind of like, it's kind of in the upper chest. It's kind of clenching, but it kind of cold. You know what I'm talking about? That kind of weird kind of clench up there?
Yeah.
You know what? Actually, I got seized by a little of that today because I'm about to have the longest run of stuff on the road, the busiest travel that I've had maybe in the last year or two. And I don't know.
Brian's next 2 weeks are show in a live night attack in San Antonio tomorrow.
Yeah.
Come back, what, fly to New York?
Fly to New York.
For a private
Do a show, yeah. And then fly home for literally an hour, long enough to pick up I don't even know why I'm flying home.
Family, Brian. Family.
Well, I mean, I'm not even going to see them. And then I have to go to Miami.
Yeah.
And we're doing events in Miami,
yeah,
and Tampa and Orlando
for the week.
Right. And then I go straight there up to Albany for my first ever performing arts gig where I'm doing two shows in one day. And it's been a hot minute since I've done the full stage
show. And these are theater shows.
Yeah, theater shows. That means everything has to be tip top.
Yeah.
I'm awake as you went through your schedule.
All right.
Well, yeah, I mean, but that's, yeah, it's a lot of, anxiety.
Anyway, I felt one of those kind of like, you know, panicky moments. And what helped today was making progress of any type on stuff that needed to be done. Like, it was so hard to start, but once I got started, it's like I felt everything relaxed. It's like no matter what else happens, I'm writing this letter, I'm booking this travel, I'm renting this car.
The expression work will set you free actually is kind of does feel true many times where like I get you just dive into a task and you're like, okay, I'm doing something, I'm paddling.
Yeah, so often the anxiety around conceptualizing what's going to happen is so much worse than actually just doing it, especially with people who are smart, I find.
So I've got a thing that I do now, and the problem is like one of my sources of anxiety is coming up with endless projects. I start this one, I'm like, well, should I keep this going? Should I drop this? Whatever. I am a serial project starter. The biggest change in my life happened when I learned how to finish things too. It was great to start things. Learning how to finish things was even better. And the problem was, is then, you know, I learned like, wow, I can write books, I can do this, but now I have to choose things. And the problem is often we don't know until we get in the middle of it where we need to go, how much effort we want to do. We talk about sunk cost fallacy, but there's the problem of that versus when you shouldn't give up and you can use whatever excuse you do. And I have a new tool that I use.
Oh.
I've talked about it briefly. And it has helped me considerably.
What is that?
And it is there's a science fiction writer who created this religion. And I'm talking about Robert Heinlein, actually. No, what I do is, I've mentioned this before, but it really has become a thing that I do. It's mission statements, whether it's a book, whether it's a project or it's something, not in a public facing, this is what I tell the world I'm going to do, in a, this is why I'm going to do it. It started with books because I wanted to make sure that I didn't get lost on the way in trying to finish a book, because I found out that now that I know how to write and I can write fast, I can turn around a book very, very quickly, but I could turn around a book and be, you know what? I missed the mark. I didn't do this with the character. I didn't do that where I wanted to go. And I made a decision about a month or so that every time I started on a project, I had to write down a mission statement and say, this book is going to be about this character. And this is gonna, it's not quite an outline. It's really, this is the, I want to have a character arc. I want to have these things. It's not so much a specific beat by bit of what happens. It's sort of the goal of the thing. So if I get adrift, I know where to go. I turned in kind of my first book since I did this, and it was a book that I wrote in 10 days, and I got a great response for my agent, my editor, and all that. I'm like, okay, this helped me stay focused on this, and now I applied to other things. So,
So we, over at Scam Stuff, we, you know, put out these mystery jackpot boxes, and they were much more popular than we had expected, and so we found ourselves with a very, very big task. And as and you know, we have a new guy on our team who's really kind of just spearheading everything, and I can't hold his hand, I can't walk him through everything. So instead, you know, I'm trying to teach him broader lessons. And one of the things that we talked about today was because he's assembling some of the boxes and working through it, and he had started putting stuff together. And we talked about, like, well, how many do you have? He's like, it's a lot. I'm like, that's not a number. You know, it's like, you know, give me the exact amount. He's like, okay, well, like, and it's like, do you have enough ingredients for all of them? He's like, almost. And like, that's not a good percentage. And it's like, you begin with the ending in mind, because if you should not pack even one box until you know why you're packing and what the goal is, how to accomplish it, you know, and all that stuff. And so we sat down and we did a mission statement where it's like, our goal is, number one, to make everybody happy. That is the most important thing. Second of all, it's to accomplish, you know, making use of these items that are valuable and awesome, but aren't currently in rotation that will be appreciated in this context. And also, if we can do it, you know, make a few bucks. And having that as a guiding, you know, actually writing that in advance made it to where he was empowered to make decisions without asking me on everything.
Mm. Well, and so often you, by not making the early decision, you supercharge how big of a problem small decisions can be along the way. So like what you did in practicality means, okay, number one priority is making everybody happy, which means if this is a thinner margin than we normally sell it at, that's fine.
Right.
Like now we don't
Or even at a loss in some
cases. Or even at a loss, yeah. Right? So it's like now you just have that guiding idea that it's like, okay, well, this is all right. It's all right to do this, as opposed to getting to a point where you're like, I don't know. Is this margin where we needed to be? It's like, just pull the Band-Aid off, right? And having that that there. And to Andrew's point, you know, for like a book, being able to say, hey, look, this is what this book is about. And from this like vantage point, this book needs to be about this. If in the process that changes, like, or I find myself drifting to do something radically different, then you want to know what? That can be the next one. But this one needs to get done.
It's something I've been applying to other tasks, because I find out it is, as you guys addressed, is that, you know, like getting those mystery boxes out the door, it could be, well, it comes down to getting it out the door. It's like, nope, number one is delight. And if we're just trying to get these things out the door, then we failed at this most important critical step, and we're not doing the thing that we set out to do. And I with my writing, like, well, I could just finish it. I'm like, no. And sometimes I've stopped projects in the middle when I had like great momentum. I'm like, yeah, I'm racing towards the finish line, but I'm not doing what I need to be doing. And I need to go back to what the core is. So I would say that, and it's we didn't, these things are hundreds of years old, the idea of a mission statement, how they apply to businesses and everything. And I would say that it's certainly something to think about applying. And, you know, in school and stuff, they ask you to do these things, but I think they're kind of provided without a context. You don't understand why you're doing this, or you're just told it's a part. It's, you know, if we're the kind of kids who would write the report and then write the outline afterwards to show that we did it.
Right.
And I encounter adults who are like, yeah, I'm like that kind. I write it afterwards. And I'm like, yeah, I was like that too. And then when I became that guy, when I had that capability, and then I added that, the ability to write the outline in the beginning and then go do it, guess what? I work out a lot better.
Well, because it's easier, you know, and that's what you, you know, I think people who are good in the moment can tend to let those habits dominate. You know, and I'm certainly very guilty of that, because it's like, eh, whatever. Like, I'll improvise along the way. It's where my best ideas come from. Like, LOL. Yeah. But really, you're overloading that. You're not giving those creative instincts kind of the time to really work. Because if you're on a path, there's plenty of opportunities where you need to think creatively. There's plenty of opportunities for you to think out of the box. The concept does not necessarily need to be freeform.
You know, that whole, oh, it's like, where are my best ideas? And I've said these things, but then as I've gotten older and more analytical, I'm like, yeah, well, why is it? Because the idea fairy decided to go visit me at that point?
Yeah.
It's no, because all of a sudden, because of other reasons, my attention was focused. So it wasn't really the fact that I waited the last minute that magic happened. It's what's because when I was really focused on it, magic happened. And maybe if I learn how focus works...
Well, and think of it as, because I've been thinking about goal setting and like, why is it that when you program yourself to get a certain thing done, that's when you have the epiphany? Because, you know, it's like, it feels like magic when you write the goal and it comes true. But basically all you're doing is you're consciously deciding the lens through which you look at the random mishmash of stuff. You're thinking about why does the moon sit there when you see the apple fall or whatever. And it's not that, you know, you see apples fall all the time, but it's through the lens of that question. And of course, that's all apocryphal. It didn't happen, but whatever. But I mean, it's a good example.
No apple has ever fallen, guys.
Yeah, correct. And there is no moon. It's a space station. But anyway, yeah, it just seems like much having a mission statement gives a clarifying element to every decision you make from that point forward. If you're adding a robot into your novel, you're like, well, is this congruous with my mission statement of, you know, making people feel something very human? It's like, well, maybe if it's about a robot who wants to become a boy or whatever.
If you have like a business project, like when I set out to do like a web project or whatever, I have to say, it's going to be X, Y, and Z. It's going to have these things in it. And I find myself sometimes suffering from, you know, feature creep and adding things to it. And I'm like, no, I finished the thing I set out to do, and maybe I'm avoiding, you know, the next step. But it's been helpful because it gives me permission when I'm in the middle of it to decide if I can walk away. I walk away if I'm like, oh, I failed the mission statement. You know, this did not satisfy it. You know, I say, okay, clearly this is not there. But if I'm like, no, this is hitting it, I'm just at this point where I'm stressed out and bored or whatever, like, well, I'm on target. My emotional, I have emotional reasons to leave, but not real ones. And, you know, the goal is to make it when you set out to do something, figure out concretely why you're doing this. Why are you trying to do this thing? If it's Brian, it's like, we got a bunch of inventory we need to clear out, and we have an opportunity to make people happy. Let's use those two things together. It is not primarily, let's make some more cash. It's like, if you can make a profit, great. Clear inventory, make people happy, and if we satisfy those two things, then we are good. If we make a little profit, good, but the first two are critical. If you fail those two things...
By the way, that's been the fun part, is realizing that what I meant to be a small thing to clear out certain parts of overstock in a fun way that would delight people, suddenly I realized, oh crap, I've done a Kickstarter, and I just crowdfunded a thing because a lot of people gave me money, and all I did was give them the promise that they would be surprised and happy with whatever I sent them. And so now I'm dealing with the issues that...
It's gonna be cocaine, right? It's gonna be cocaine. Yeah.
Now I'm dealing with the issues that come with that of course Justin's all too familiar with, where I realize like, okay, there's no way to get them everything instantly because while it's here, what I'm promising is an individualized experience and all that stuff. And so now what I have to do is, you know, I am also selling a story, which means I am writing, you know, emails every other day saying, you know, here's where we're at, here's what's happening. Like today, I just sent an email saying, hey, we're literally packing your thing. Super important survey. It's got one question, and it just went there, and you're like, what's your order number? Hey, do you mind if we send you something alcohol related? Like, and that's it. And they're like, peace out. But it lets them know this is not a fantasy. I'm not selling fairy dust. I'm not going to take their money, leave them looking like a sucker, like Justin was saying is the number one concern.
Well, that's the big fear with any kind of Kickstarter thing or something like that you're doing now, which is that nobody wants to be made a fool out of, you know, because A, it sucks when you buy something that you know what you're getting and it turns out to be less than what you expect. It double sucks when you actually believe in something or you are trusting somebody, especially somebody with scam in their store's title. And you know, you hope that this isn't an LOL. You know, like, oh, you get a bag of fleas. Ha ha! Another classic jape from Brian Brushwood.
Hang on, let me write this down.
What's the fleas cost?
I know, yeah. Is that legal to send in the mail? But yeah, you know, it's a real interesting thing. But I mean, what Andrew got to is really important, because right now that's the situation that we're at. We're writing a new card game, and right now we are at the point where it is not fun. Like the fun part was the concept. The fun part was getting the initial puzzle pieces to work. It will be fun again once we start playtesting it in a more finished form, and we can see how people interact with it, and like that ball of clay can sort of start jumping and dancing to life, and you can be very proud of it. But right now, we're in the like polishing the edges in the dark phase, which is like very, 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 very unrewarding.
You're that 3-day rock tumbler running, where it's just like you just got to keep cranking that thing until everything's smooth.
It just sucks, and it sucks so much because you don't know. You can put a lot of work into something, and all of a sudden find out that nobody likes that part, or everybody finds it confusing, and now all of a sudden you got to just cut it, or you got to change it, or there's a lot of stuff that like in that process is just the not fun element of it. And you see that in comedy too. Comedy, especially if you're working on like a longer form thing.
Oof.
Like now all of a sudden you're thinking about pauses and ways to interact with stuff. And you know from doing a stage show, like there's a point where a stage show is fun.
Yeah. And, well, it's novel. Like, look at me, I did it. They're clapping.
And then you get to a point where it's like, well, this is about doing this a billion times. And now playing the Guitar Hero video game of like, well, that one didn't get as much of a applause line as it normally does. Is it because they suck or I suck? And let's now put it into my spreadsheet in my brain. Okay, well, let's say, well, they also didn't laugh at all these other stuff. Let's go ahead and say they suck. Let's like think about what we're going to do the next time we book this. I didn't do this and they laughed at that, but they didn't laugh at this. Did I screw up? Did I do something? Should I tighten it? Like, it's a lot of unfun self-questioning.
Yeah. Well, and there are literal 70-minute shows that I began with like this one line. I'm going to nail this one line. And I go through the whole show and I get to that one part where I'm just like, you know, because like the night before I had like an alternate take on it or whatever. So it's like you're doing a 70-minute performance for literally a 10-second moment just and that's what you're focused on so that
no,
you can smooth that rock.
The clean hand.
Yeah.
God, what a dick line that is.
Oh, yeah. No, that entire magician are awful. Like that entire dynamic. If I remember correctly, Seinfeld had the best line. Every magic trick is the same. Here's the quarter. Now it's gone. You're a jerk. Now it's back. You're still a jerk. Show's over.
Yeah. But yeah. But that's, to me, that's what separates people who get stuff done and people who don't. And also, it's the pratfall. The pitfall, rather. I guess you could also make it a pratfall because it is comedic in how hilarious your destruction is. But, like, for a long time, I was seduced and had to work on myself from not just considering something done because I told people about it and they were like, great! And I'm like, awesome! Well, that's pretty much all I wanted out of this whole project was people to like it. So, and people to call me really smart, kind of don't have to do it now, you know, because, you know, beyond that, there's a valley.
Yeah.
And there's a greater glory on the other side. But who wants to walk through that valley when you could just get all the cheap heat?
You know, when I've been doing a lot of Periscope sessions and I talk a lot about writing and the thing, and I get questions like, well, how much money can you make with writing? I'm like, well, let's start. If that's your opening question, this is not for you.
Yeah.
And the thing I try to explain to people is that you go from, there's the part of you that's like, I want to see this finished complete thing, big book. And you know, like that's all, and it is awesome to hold on to a finished complete book. That is cool. By the way, I found out they're doing an audiobook for The Naturalist too.
Oh, awesome.
So, and that's awesome. But the thing that I discovered was I have this, like, there was the, oh, I love to have the idea for the thing. And then I love to have the finished thing. But when I learned to enjoy the middle, the actual doing the work, it became a totally different experience. My reason for writing totally changed. And now it's, you know, I write stuff that I never release. And I learned to like that. And the problem I got into is I liked that so much that I kind of like, man, I'll just sit down and write it. If it's great, it's great. It's not, but I'm like, Yeah, but if I'm trying to hit a goal or make something specific happen, I better state what that is in advance and not just sort of hope that I hit it, which is, I think, a mistake a lot of writers make.
Well, yeah, I mean, it really is a hard, it's a hard road to hoe if you don't rewire your brain. But part of it is also just like, it is kind of a two-phase thing, because number one, you have to have the faith that you can do this thing, right? And get like in the process of doing it. And then once you believe in yourself, then you can rewire your brain to be better at doing it, you know, but like, It's complex, and you know, there's really, you know, I had somebody, he's been DMing me a bunch about like writing, like journalism writing, and you know, he's asked me a bunch of questions. I've been happy to answer them, and hit me up this week, and he's like, "Hey, don't sugarcoat it for me. Like, am I a crap writer? Like, I'm not here for a pat in the back. Like, am I a crap writer?" And I was like, "Well, you know, you're better than you were. You're not as good as you'll be in a year, and you're nowhere near as good as you'll be in 10 years. So, like, there is no secret sauce to, like, being, I mean, like, some of the people that I knew that were naturally kind of garbage as newspaper writers when I first started in college are the ones that are working in the profession today at the highest ranks, because they worked harder and better, and they got better and better and better. And like, there's just no, there's no easy way to do it, right? If you want to be great, it means doing it all, like you will be embarrassed by what you did initially. Fact.
There was a story that I heard, I've mentioned this before, but years ago, I took a comedy class on learning how to, you know, because I just wanted to, I had no interest in being a stand-up comedian, but I wanted to take stand-up comedy classes just to understand that part of entertainment. And the guys who put on this show, put on the class, they were actually bookers that booked other people. And they told a story about how they were booking shows, I think they're in New York area. And they talked about they used to book shows, and they'd get this guy, this young comic, would call him up and say, "Hey, do you have any spots for me?" And they're like, "No, you're not funny. We don't like to use you because of that." He's like, he just wants to be the opener. The opener is like the lowest, you know, the lowest thing in there. It's the guy that starts off when people are just coming in and getting their drinks. It's like, "I'll drive your acts. I'll drive your comedy acts around. I'll pick him up from the condo, take him to the show, drive him back." And I'm like, "All right, but you know, it's only $40. It's like, I'll do it. And so they would pay him the $40. He'd go pick up the comics. He'd drive him to the show. He'd go do a stinky, it's just bad show. Then he'd sit through, watch the show. Then he'd get in the car. He'd drive the comics back, and he would ask them questions.
Yeah.
"How do I get better? What do I need to do? What am I doing wrong?" Kept doing it. It started off like he's 18, 19 years old, started doing this, kept doing it. And he kept calling him up, being really, he was a likable guy, but he's not a good comedian. He's just very, very persistent about that. But he kept, that was his thing. His part of the process was, if he drove, he wasn't just, "Hey, drive so I'll get the gig. He was drive the acts so he could talk to them, have them trapped in a car, get advice from them, and start figuring out what he needed to do that. Eventually he gave up comedy, because he already was successful as Chris Rock and then could move on to other things. It was Chris Rock. And that was the story they talked about him. They said, he was not funny. Like, you understand, like, he's not funny. They were in shock of the fact that now he's just really funny.
It's a mega comic, right?
Yeah, top comics of the world. And like, we know Chris when Chris was not good. Like, we know Chris was, but Chris would call us up, ask for these, you know, ask for this gig, beg, do this drive. But he was learning. That was their point, was he was learning how to get better. And they said he started off really, really, really bad, and he became great. Eddie Murphy was like a natural. And we talk about this where we get obsessed with people who are naturals, who are the prodigies. When we're teenagers, we want to be that. We want to have everything work out right for us. Then we find out that we really actually have to work. And if you really study prodigies, you don't want to be a prodigy. They have burnouts.
Oh, my gosh. No, yeah, that's the core, you know, that's the core start of every tragedy is the guy who has it all, or the gifted person who everything's given to them. They don't appreciate it, and they make poor decisions. They overassume what they're capable of, and then they crater and crumble. And because they haven't built up the strength that comes from punching a rock 10,000 hours, you know, that they don't know how to deal with the failure. Yeah. And it really is like, not, it's so important you're going to be bad before you be good, which means, and we talked about this a million times, you need to have a safe space to be bad before you can be good. And, you know, scam school in the beginning, you go back there, they're not my best on-camera appearances. And BB Live Show, I would say, is not the tightest comedy performances Justin and I have ever done. But we kept showing up. And same thing with, man, it would be interesting to go back and listen to some of the very first episodes of Weird Things, because I feel like we have a much more natural flow to our conversation now compared to where we did back then.
Well, I've said this before. I've watched the evolution of you guys doing podcasting or stuff like this on almost a daily basis. And I look at myself and I go, you guys are years ahead of me. And we started all around the same time, but where at most I was doing one podcast a week, you guys are doing several, three, four, or five or whatever, and continuously doing that. I can see that. I listen and I can tell the difference between the guys who do it every day and this guy over here who does it once a week. Yeah. And, you know, I'll be the first to admit, it's proof that this thing works, the process of keep doing it.
Although that's what's so admirable. Not that you're Gandhi or whatever, but like, that's what I like seeing about you doing the Periscopes, right? Where it's like you found a new niche, a new opportunity to reach out to people. And you, I assume, because you're doing those, what, every day, every other day?
A couple of days, yeah.
Yeah, and it's like you have now done 20 to 30 times the number of Periscopes I've done. And it's very difficult to keep up a one-sided conversation to a cell phone, you know? And how quickly are you seeing the transformation of how natural it feels and how quickly you build up your ability to cover for common, you know, let's say, connection hiccups or people asking questions or trolls or whatever?
Yeah, I mean, like, I'm learning how to kind of like quickly get rid of somebody, spot who is a really going to be a troll and who's just being a goofball, and just so it doesn't. I don't care, but it's like, oh, they're driving people nuts in the chat. How to do that? The biggest thing that I have is, because it's just this sort of freeform thing, I get the same questions as other people come in there. Is how do I not make it feel too repetitious? Because like, I'm like, kind of like, if you've seen one Periscope session I've done, I kind of feel like you've probably seen them all. But I have new people come in all the time who really enjoy it, because they never get a chance to talk to somebody who makes a living being creative in, you know, different mediums. So that's the thing I'm at right now. How do I make it feel fresh each time? Which I don't know that I've done that. And I look at, you know, people who do daily shows, daily things like that, and even like Weird Things, we recycle it's on me a lot of the same topics over and over again. There's always sort of a fun twist to it, but it still can be repetitious. So with the Periscope, that's one of the big struggles I'm wrestling with. And then, you know, you have to learn how do I just keep the conversation going when there are no questions. Because what I do now is I just launch right into, you know, I just start off like, here's the thing, I've first 7 or 8 minutes or whatever, I'm just talking about what I'm doing.
Yep.
And I often don't get questions because people are just listening. And then I got to go like, oh, if you guys have any questions, then the flow of questions starts and then I can't even keep up.
Yeah. Well, and it's weird.
It's very, very hard. And this is something that I, you know, open by you in the chat mentioned in terms of like getting better at stuff. I wanted to get good at one mic stuff. And like my initial attempts at that are not good. Like, they are thudding. Like, I would consider that a failure now, right? But it's like, there's a necessity to getting good at what Andrew's getting good at right now, which is like understanding where pauses need to be, understanding where it's okay to take your breath, and understanding where, for Andrew's got even a higher degree of difficulty, because like he said, here's the worst thing you can do when nobody's talking. Ask for people to talk for you.
Yeah.
Right? And just say like, hey, what's your questions?
Awkward pause,
right? But if, like Andrew said, he goes through 20 minutes of, here's the context and here's what we're doing and here's how you do it and this is what I've done. Here's an experience. Here's a story. Here's some stuff I've read on it. What do you guys think about that? Any further questions now that we've walked 20 minutes down this path? Bunch of questions. All of a sudden, you've inflated the balloon, and now people come at you. But that's something that you don't know until you do it, and there's still a refinement process, I'm sure.
One of the things I've learned and I picked up on was, if you're gonna get the same question over and over again, is learn how to answer it different ways. Because often people like ask you a question like, well, how should I answer this? Because like, I answer it this way. I'm like, oh no, I just put it into a context of a thing I started talking about before. And that way, people who've listened, because there are people who I would listen to ad nauseum who just anything they say, I'm like, not to say that I think anybody feels that about me, but I'm like, I do know that there are people that I would love to hear them give me 20 answers, 20 different approaches to the same question.
Well, and we see a bit of that. I think the One Mic Show is an interesting case study because you get someone like an Adam Carolla who it's like, if you've listened to him long enough, you heard him repeat stories a million times. And the reason for that is because while, yes, he's repeating the story a million times, there's no way you've listened to everything he's ever done. There's no way anyone could listen to everything he's ever done. And the odds are the majority of the people listening right now are hearing him for one of the very first times, and this is the first time for them to hear that story. For example, nowadays when you listen to, for example, the Penn Sunday School podcast, there is such a confidence, and he's telling stories, and he's got referees where it's like he'll start to go into a story, and they know that he's said this story on the podcast before, and they'll let him know, and he'll give a much short and tightened version of it and keep on going. Whereas you listen to him when he first started on Real FM, Real Radio back in the day. Technically, all the structure was almost identical, but there was just a tightness to everything and those brief semantic crutches, and then the odd moment that he just suddenly reads a canned joke that he has in case he doesn't have anything to think of that's timely or whatever. And I don't know. I would imagine you've gone through a similar journey with The Jury and are continuing with the Periscopes.
Certainly so, you know, but J.C. Calhoun in the chat right now just says, you know, there's also the fact that sometimes people like hearing the same stories over and over again, that it's comforting, you know, to know, if you think a story is, or you think something is going to trigger a story and then it does, you're happy because in your brain you were like, oh yes, that's, I thought he was going to talk about that. He should. I hope maybe it'll change his conclusions because of this. Like, it's weird. It's a very complex matrix.
Well, like last night when I was setting up the Kevin Smith story with Cargill, I knew exactly how the story went, but I was really interested to hear it all again from a different perspective, right? Yeah. And I'm sure you watched part of it unfold. I'm sure there are people who knew more about it than, you know, even I did. And yet, that ended up being like a 40-minute epic saga telling all these different viewpoints that all collapsed to this one, you know, roundabout moment, in which case Kevin Smith's anger ends up creating Cargill.
Sure, yeah.
I remember when I worked with the amazing Randy, and Randy has great stories. Randy's one of the most amazing raccoteurs you could ever imagine when it comes to these stories, because this is a guy that knew everybody, went everywhere. This is a guy who could hang out with, you know, Arthur C. Clarke and Isaac Asimov and Robert Heinlein and then Carl Sagan and Richard Feynman, and then go out into Hollywood and do this sort of stuff. So you can imagine the sort of scope of stories that he had. Of course, I would, you know, having known him since I was a teenager, you know, I would joke, he'd start a story like, did I ever tell you this? I'd go, 42, you know, 13. And I'd kind of, you know, tease him with the fact that he'd start telling the stories. But I don't have stories. I mean, I have a handful of stories, but I don't have stories. And then when people ask me questions, I'll start to go through the same thing. And I start to have little bits of stories. But I appreciate that ability, what he had, and the ability to do that, and like what Kevin Smith has, and to be able to do that. But also the other side of it is, yeah, man, you know, I fear that fear of repetition of all of a sudden people are like,
you know what? Here's what I realized. Because when I was 19 years old and I toured with C.J. Johnson, he was in his late 30s, and it blew my mind that he kept making the same political observations, kept telling the same stories, kept complaining about the same things. And I would be like, yeah, you said this, you said all of this, you said, you know, what is it with old people who you know, just keep repeating the same stuff? And now that I'm on the other side of that, I realize, no, what's important to them is to get the story right. They don't care. It's not important to keep a mental registry of everyone they've told the story to and who they've told it from.
Yeah, but I have this fear of becoming just sort of a loop. And I find myself very often just doing the same thing over and over. And I have like a 1 or 2 year period. I like this 1 year. Like, I remember when I moved into my house in South Florida, my townhouse, and that, you know, it was kind of my first year just being a creative on my own, creating magic tricks and stuff. I hadn't worked with Justin yet. A year went by that I cannot tell you what I did in that year. It's like a blackout period. And that scared the hell out of me because I'm like, I'm still a young guy. And this is, and I understand, like, part, like, have kids because your life will be filled with a lot. There will definitely be moments when you're by yourself in a little townhouse like this. I can't remember a single thing from that year.
That was having a day job for me. That was that the fastest year of my entire life was once I got good at my job at Dell, and every day was the same. And every day was a lifetime. Every year was a minute. And I was just like, I don't want to blink and have it be all over. Right. So that was the nice thing about going on tour. Was every challenge was completely different, and there were elements that were the same, and then you had tools available, but it was like you were slaying a different monster every night.
That's when I made the decision, go for TV, go do what's the biggest, most crazy thing you could do. And I'm like, you know, kind of maybe I want to be on TV. Maybe that's the sort of thing I want to do. And it wasn't like it had been a desire when I was 13. It wasn't when I was older, but I'm like, pretend it's your passion.
Yeah.
Pretend it's your passion.
Although I will say this, you know, when I was working with Andrew, I mean, it was every day for lunch, get together with Andrew, go have lunch, go drive to whatever Arby's, Taco Bell, you know, whatever.
And nothing but the finest.
Nothing but the finest. Or wait, what was the Rolly, the roll restaurant that we went to a bunch initially? It was like all this, like, anyway. Long story short, I'm sure that there were times, just days, where Andrew and I would just be these pre-programmed Furbies that would just tell each other the same story back and forth. That if everything was recorded, I would bet you that there were at least 2 days in which our back and forth was almost identical.
Isn't that the stereotype?
Roly poly, yes, it was. Roly poly. That was the story.
Isn't that the stereotype of two old friends, you know, like you know, 80-year-olds telling the same stories over and over and over
Very
again?
Very kind of you to not go married couple, but yes.
Yeah.
But no, I mean, but that's like, you know, you just there was a point in which, you know, you run out of stories, keep telling the stories, and it was fine, you know? Like, it was.
Yeah, but the best times when we were doing new and different stuff, the best stories were working on our first pilot and getting so punch drunk we almost lost your eye.
Yes.
Or just, you know, that was sort of one of the things I said, you know what, I need to live a more interesting life and go do things and not just fall into this, become a Westworld robot on a loop.
Yeah. Oh, totally. I mean, that's the best. The best times were, yeah. No, what was it? No power tools after 4 a.m.
Oh, God.
It was one time. All right. One story, since we're on the subject of stories, as part of Andrew's one of the pilots that we shot, there was a thing that we were doing where without giving away the trick, I needed to ride a little mini motorcycle through as small of a hole as possible. And so we had to figure out how small the hole could be, how we had to build it into what we needed to build it into. And so we're in this industrial park in Broward County, Florida, and I'm on this little mini motorcycle, and we are punch drunk. Like, it is late, and we're on these, like, meh, 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 like these little.
We've got a deadline. We've got to get load a whole trailer up with all of our gear to go to Orlando to go shoot a pilot for Rhymes with MTV.
Oh my God!
And by the way, this is going to be in a crowded park.
Under pressure.
Oh. And this is like days away that we have to do this. And we got to figure out how to do it. And also how to stage manage everybody who is not us that is going to have to do the exact same thing, because there's people that aren't us. So we got to get it scientifically down. And so like, I'm the guinea pig because Andrew has to watch it and see how it looks and everything. And I go and like, pah, and I just hit the side. I hit the side.
No, well,
of the
first
frame.
Time. You start to drive, and you just you're about 2 feet away from the hole, and you just fall over on your side. he just goes, and then over, because he just lost his balance. His inner ear just went to sleep. It's like, I'm just going to fall over, take a nap. And we're giggling. We're cackling and laughing at how funny it was, because he's just like, right? We're like, all right. He's like, all right, I'll do this again. Then you get up to go through it.
And well, and then, you know, I just remember there was just a moment where I hit the frame, And
I had these two metal bars holding this thing up, these two pieces like angle L iron holding this square up, pointing straight at the direction you're coming from. Okay. Now, I could have pointed the other way. Did make sense. Did was perfectly fine the way it was. So they understand that's number one. Is I've set up this death trap of like these footbug black metal in the middle of the dark, pointing right at eye level.
I just remember Andrew's like, no judgment. Are you driving straight? And I just look up and I'm like, I think so. Like, it feels like I'm driving straight. And so he's like, all right, let me just, I'm not going to look at it at the angle that we're going to shoot at. I just want to see whether or not you're going to kill yourself. So he walks to the front to see how I'm driving. And he's like, no, you're definitely like veering fully to the left. Because like, I just kept trying to overcompensate by like getting like to overcompensate for my list that I didn't realize that I was doing.
Wow.
So he goes and he does it, and it's like he bap the thing, like hits him in the helmet or whatever, right? Hits him in the helmet, and taps him, and he falls back, and we're laughing, we're hysterics, and then I look at this piece of angle iron, I'm like, if that was an inch lower, you would have lost your eye.
Oh,
we're like,
because by the way, this is another element of it. The way the thing was, you had to get X amount of speed to go over it.
Right.
So you couldn't just like go slow. You had to like get going or else I would hit it.
It was do or die.
Yeah, it would trap and I would fall like through the thing, but not on the God. Oh man. But that was hilarious. That was great.
We were in hysterics, and then we had this sort of like, oh man, no, that was almost really horrible in the trip.
That was almost a hospital trip.
Yeah.
But anyway. And then sometimes we would tell the same stories about, you know, our theories on who we would cast for a new Star Trek. You know,
Star Wars too.
And Star Wars. Oh yeah. No. We booked all the territories. All right. Well, I'll tell you what. Do we have picks?
Yeah, real quick. My pick is Voltron, because I'm going to sit down and watch it. It's a Netflix original. Second season is much better than the first, and I'm hoping to be able to watch another episode of it with my daughter tonight.
Andrew?
My pick is, I'm gonna just keep going back and saying I'm always finding new ways to use my little notepad app on my iPhone, and I love my iPhone. I love this. I hope someday Apple develops a technology that would allow me to like directly transfer files from my iPhone back and forth to my Mac. I mean, I know they have a thing they call, like, you know, that's supposed to do that, but it don't work reliably. But I do find that if I need to drop AirDrop does not work for me consistently. Mm. So if I need to do it, I just drop an image into my Notes app and it appears everywhere, because Notes has gotten really, really good. I outlined an entire book Monday in Notes sitting in my bed on my iPad, like, you know, like 30 chapters of outline just for, and like, I don't remember having to type it. It just flowed. So
yeah. Wow. That's great.
Yeah. Notes app.
My pick is a super high tech way that I have become more productive, especially when it comes to visualizing the weeks ahead. Cause I've always been trapped in the week. Like, I've always just thought about Monday through Friday. That's the farthest that my brain would stretch. Right. And it's often got me into trouble.
Mm-hmm.
Dry erase calendar.
It's the best thing ever.
It's a 1 month dry erase calendar. It forces me at the beginning of every month to write it out and write out the days and see how many like Mondays I have, yada, yada, yada. Like it allows me to add things. I got into the habit lately of writing like the big goal for the day, like my own little like statement of purpose and mantra for the day, and freed, made me think more about that, like that on Saturday and Sunday, it's relax. Like, it's just take the time to do exactly what you want and enjoy the fruits of your labor. But on, you know, days like this week, it's made me think more about stuff. Like, the reason why we're doing this now on Wednesday is because I'm not going to be around Sunday, right?
Right.
And so we have all probably could stand to be better about communicating, you know, like conflicts and stuff like that. The dry erase board made me say, I'm going to be gone for 2 weeks.
I need to bank episodes to certain shows when I know that it's not going to be reliable for me to be able to do stuff on certain days. I'd rather just have a banked episode for a lot of the stuff that I'm doing. If there's a conflict that I can switch around, let's send that email a week ahead of time as opposed to 48 hours ahead of time. It's done wonders for me in a way that Google Calendar never really could for me, just because, and I'm sure, listen, if there was a big, awesome digital display where I could do everything that I could do on a thing.
One that was persistent 24 hours in the periphery of your vision, something that would intrude on your eyesight line.
Then maybe I could do the same thing, right? Yeah. And maybe it would be even better. But for right now, Dry Erase Calendar has done wonders for me being more proficient, because at the point where I'm doing as many podcasts as I'm doing now, and I have to work with as many different people as I do, it just, there's like, I can't afford to be negligent about that kind of pre-planning. And it's been a wonder. So there we go. Dry Erase, big wall calendar.
Bri, you were alluding to something.
I don't know. Was I with
a calendar? Do you have like some magic?
Dry. No. I when I heard dry erase, I went nuts because dry erase board is a way to again. I'm a big fan of writing your goals and posting them in the shower because it intrudes on a time that you normally would not be thinking about this problem or whatever, and it guides you in that direction. It reminds you this is a pressing thing. This is what you told yourself you do. Dry erase boards do that for short term, you know, projects and everything. Bonnie is the same way. She can't. She never took to any electronic calendar of any type at all.
Yeah.
And when it's worked the best for me, it's been a live and die by the calendar thing. Yeah. Electronically.
I use this thing, that wall calendar. Last year it was a dry erase. I thought I was buying a dry erase, but it wasn't. This is actually, you know, an actual write-on, but same difference.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely.
So I use a full year. The reason I use a full year is because, like, if I have something booked way out, I want to be able to see that it's coming. And I remember, like, I learned that actually Randy was working with Randy, because Randy had his yearly calendar, and Randy would be on the phone like, hey, we want to see about booking him for such and such, and watch Randy get up and, well, let me look at the calendar. He physically have a calendar to go look at. And I can see, like, at some point, if I had a big, huge digital display, it may be cool. But I live and die by that thing. So,
yeah, I would very much like for, you know, monitors and touchscreen technology to get to the point where I could have a fully, transferable, and I could go easily from, you know, 30 days to 5 days or to 1 day. But until that happens, until those single use touchscreen, flat screen monitors are flooding the market, I feel like the dry erase bird is it's fine. It's good. It makes me be active in my own planning, which is important.
Just a closing thought, too, is that January is almost up.
Yeah.
2017, man. I was saying this before, like, that's a thing, is like, before you know it, it's the middle of the year.
Yeah. Though, and again, for anyone who's like, oh, man, but that's a lot of work. Write down your goal, write down the deadline, and yes, it will be a lot of work, but here's the good news. The time is going to pass anyway, period.
Yep.
And
true fact.
Done it.
We're all in a very slow time machine, no matter what.
it is. No, that's right.
Gentlemen, it's been after.
Yes, you're goddamn right it is.
All right, I'm going to go watch Voltron. Love you guys.
Good job, Justin.
Yeah, man. Good job by you.
I rolled my eyes in case you didn't notice.
With what?
My eyeballs. I rolled my eyes.
Oh, okay, sure.
With what? All right. What are you doing now?
I am probably gonna go stream more with Willie Dills. I think I'm gonna catch an Uber down to his place and stream some video games, and then wake up early tomorrow, head down to San Antone.
Cool. I think I'm gonna just do a quick Periscope session. I'm supposed to write, but I'll do that before I start writing. Thank you. Have fun.
All right. Bye, guys. Bye. We are out.